Good evening. It's election night in many parts of America. My name is Josh Scacco, Assistant Professor of Political Communication in the Brian Lamb School of Communication. At this moment, across the United States, in 11 states, voters are choosing the next President of the United States and the individual who will represent them in their party's, in their presidential party going forward in November. On the Democratic side, Democrats across the United States are choosing between former Secretary of State Hillary Clinton, Vermont Senator Bernie Sanders. And at stake tonight on the Democratic side are 865 delegates that will be taken with these candidates to the Democratic National Convention in July. On the Republican side, Republican voters are choosing between five different candidates that will represent them in the fall contest. Businessman Donald Trump, Senator Ted Cruz of Texas, Senator Marco Rubio of Florida, former neurosurgeon Ben Carson, and Ohio Governor John Kasich. On the Republican side are 661 delegates across the states of Alabama, Georgia, Vermont, Virginia, Massachusetts, Oklahoma, Tennessee, and Texas. We are within a half an hour of the first poll closings in Alabama, Georgia, Vermont, and Virginia. And the initial exit poll suggests that, at least on the Republican side, 50% of Republican voters feel that their party has betrayed them in some way. Additionally, a quarter of Republican voters have made up their mind recently. As we will be here with you throughout the evening as the returns come in, with a panel of experts from the Department of Political Science here at Purdue. We will also have expert commentary from Alexander Heffner of PBS's The Open Mind, Mitch Daniels, the president of Purdue, as well as students who are here at a watch party being sponsored by the Department of Political Science, the Brian Lamb School of Communication, the Honors College here at Purdue, as well as the Office of the President. We're looking forward to being here with you tonight. And I actually want to bring in at this moment Alexander Heffner of PBS's The Open Mind to talk a little bit about what dynamics and what's at stake tonight in the Super Tuesday primaries that are taking place across the southern, western, and midwestern United States. Alexander, thanks so much for being with us today.
Josh, it's been a pleasure to be with you all day. We've been in the classroom, on the campus, thinking about the implications of the millennial vote, the implications of the Super Tuesday outcome. You painted the picture. It's a broad vote that sweeps across the country. And I think at the end of the night, we'll know if we have a clear idea of who the two-party nominees will be.
Absolutely, absolutely. So let's talk a little bit more about that right now. And let's start, I think a lot of attention leading up to this has been on the Republican side, but let's start first with the Democrats in terms of thinking about the dynamics that are playing out between Hillary Clinton and Bernie Sanders. What do you see as the main factors that might influence the prospective vote for Hillary Clinton tonight?
Well, I haven't been in the field as much as I had been the last two presidential cycles. But it promises to be a contest of ideas, whereas the Republican contest has been a contest of insult and injury. It seems now, unlike 2 weeks ago, maybe a month ago, that the Republican nominee or eventual nominee will end up more bruised and bloodied than the eventual Democratic nominee. There seems to be, since Nevada, consensus around Hillary Clinton as the electable Democrat. In states like Minnesota and Colorado tonight, Bernie Sanders has an edge, as he does in his native Vermont. He does in states that are homogeneously white, but when you talk about a multiplicity of diverse voices in a more pluralistic society, where a majority of voters in Texas are a majority minority state, you have an opportunity for former Secretary of State Clinton to exploit that. And she did that in Nevada. She did that to a tremendous extent in South Carolina. So I think it'll be interesting to see if Secretary Clinton is able to galvanize non-white constituencies in a way that competed with then-Senator Obama in 2008, because there hasn't been the same interest in the Democratic campaign as there has been in the Republican. And turnout is going to be in a severe drought for the Democrats unless they coalesce around a single candidate. And I've been saying for several weeks now, if Clinton is going to win, she's going to have to integrate not only the Sanders messaging, but his fundraising, boots on the ground, canvassing, organizing apparatus right. in order to win. So, you know, you'll see how much momentum Sanders still has coming off of that huge win in New Hampshire. And ultimately, it's a contest of delegates. And when we do the math, it's quite possible that Sanders is still in contention in a way that Rubio and Cruz are not, which is the sort of ironic development. The Republicans are sure that they don't want Donald Trump, at least the establishment Republicans are. They sure they don't want Donald Trump as their nominee, except it seems like a foregone conclusion. I am expecting, though, I mean, I'm expecting, and as a non-analyst, but as someone who, as you know, is an advocate of civic discourse, civility in politics, and the work that I do on The Open Mind on PBS, you know, I am hoping that the coalition of Republicans becomes more diverse, mm-hmm. and as the junior senator of Nebraska said, you know, is not co-opted by fringe elements, whether that's the KKK or other hate groups, because then Trump's bully pulpit becomes not only an electoral problem for him in November, but something that can spew ugliness in our discourse and in the rhetoric of American politics in a way that may not have been palpable since George Wallace.
Okay.
So, you know, you have the opportunity for Cruz to win Texas, and you have the opportunity for Rubio to be competitive in a number of states. And if he can win a state like Virginia, then his argument is bolstered that he can be competitive beyond Super Tuesday.
Sure. So thinking about the Republicans as well, and you started to get into some of the dynamics in the Republican race, it's obviously gotten quite raucous within the past week, particularly between Donald Trump and Marco Rubio. and how do you think that played in terms of late deciders? When we're looking at exit polls that show roughly 20% of the potential electorate in terms of many of these Republican races made up their mind relatively recently.
Yeah. That helps Rubio.
You think it helps Rubio?
I think it helps Rubio. I mean, the late deciders in the most recent contests did veer in the Cruz or Rubio direction.
Okay.
You know, he really, in a way, surprised people who expected this robotic consultant's dream of a candidate.
Sure.
Who had that devastating fumble before New Hampshire. He stymied some expectations that he was going to continue to be robotic Rubio.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he expanded his appeal and demonstrated a genuineness that you might not have seen. And as we were saying earlier, you know, I come from the school of political thought that personality, use the word Trump, personality trumps Trump, it trumps everything.
Sure.
And right now, Donald Trump is exploiting the fact that the American electorate for decades has been asked, you know, with what candidate would you rather have a beer?
Mm-hmm.
The answer to that is Trump, but, you know, for many people, there was the expectation that an implosion would lead enough Americans to think, no, I don't want to have a beer with this candidate who wants to punch a protester and who leads to a rally in which a Secret Service agent, I mean an environment in which a Secret Service agent would chokehold a Time magazine photographer. And I think it has a permanently, potentially scarring impact on civic life in this country. And, you know, it's really hard to fathom that a candidate like Trump can do a 180 degree turn. And I'm not talking about policy. I'm talking mm-hmm. about the impression of the electorate that he's unstable. And it's not clear if the lack of favorability, which is a consensus across the general election, would turn into the belief or really demonstrates the conviction that he's unstable, that he is not fit to be president.
Right. So thinking about, in many ways, these contests get boiled down to who is the least like the current occupant of the White House, Barack Obama. And I think in many ways, you see this playing out as well on both the Republican and the Democratic side.
Right.
In what ways has distancing himself from the president hurt Bernie Sanders potentially in terms of his momentum with many key groups going forward? For example, African-American voters, Hispanic voters who are very much, view the president in a quite favorable light.
Well, it's a good question. My sense is that Sanders has been positioning himself such that he can remain popular and consistent with the Occupy constituency.
Sure.
And you're referring to the Occupy Wall Street movement.
And
you know, the Occupy Wall Street movement, although many African Americans and Hispanic Americans were victims of foreclosure, mm-hmm. and victims of the Great Recession and victims of the near Great Depression that we experienced. You know, the failure, I think, of the Sanders campaign, and he was on my show and I got to experience Sanders in the flesh. He's quite affable,
sure.
contrary to the curmudgeon that, you know, Larry David portrays on SNL. You know, I think his failure is not in electoral strategy so much as it has been in his inability to convey the political extension of Obama in a way that puts him in line
right.
as the natural successor.
Okay.
And it's hard to do when you have President Obama's former Secretary of State on the same stage, mm-hmm. saying this is the president who trusted me and trusted me with the office mm-hmm. of Secretary of State. But you know, he said that the Republicans have amnesia and that they forget what this country was experiencing in 07 and 08. Mm-hmm. And it's a fair point, but he doesn't sufficiently show that it was the obstruction, not President Obama's unwillingness, but it was the obstruction in D.C. that led to an intransigence that was not going to break a two-party gridlock
right.
On reform, mm-hmm. Serious progressive reform that could radically alter the socioeconomic status of the country. I think the moniker of democratic socialism has hurt him more than helped him.
Interesting.
President Obama was never aligned with that kind of identity, mm-hmm. Despite Republican efforts to taint him in kind of socialistic Bill Ayers light.
Right.
It never stuck.
And absolutely something that we will get more into tonight in
yeah.
terms of thinking about the labels that both Republicans and Democrats have thrown at each other. Hillary Clinton arguing that she's a progressive, and much to the chagrin of many hardcore Bernie Sanders supporters. So we will be right back with you tonight for more of Super Tuesday coverage here from Purdue.
Good evening. My name is Trevor Peters. I am a junior in the College of Liberal Arts studying mass communication, and I am a student in the Brian Lamb School of Communication. And I'm going to be one of your co-moderators tonight along with senior Island Sapahi. So I'm here with Allegra Aguirre. She is a sophomore in the College of Liberal Arts studying political science. And my first question for you, Allegra, just how important this Super Tuesday is in this awesome race that we have.
Today is a pivotal moment for anyone hoping to win the bid for the White House. It's the most number of primaries that will be held across the U.S., so it's a great day to see a close race and hopefully get some underdogs coming out from the shadows.
So what underdogs are you looking for in both parties?
No one in particular at the moment, but I'm just hoping to see maybe those dominant parties get a little bit of a run for their money tonight.
So what are your expectations in the coming hours? Do you think people like Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton, do you think they'll continue to stay so dominant?
I think it just depends on, you know, really how many people turn out for the primaries today and maybe how much Donald Trump tweets tonight. So,
how much he tweets?
Yeah.
So then, on the topic of social media, how do you think social media has played a role so far in this 2016 primary?
It's definitely, you know, piqued my interest. I think in the past elections, I haven't been as interested in what's going on. But as far as the media coverage and even on Facebook and Snapchat, you know, they're starting to cover these big issues. And it's really helping a lot of students like myself and people from, you know, the 18 to 24 range just pay attention a little bit more to the major issues that are taking over. We're going to start taking over these issues and we need to focus on what they are.
So yeah, you've seen candidates like Ted Cruz, he periscopes all the time, and you see Marco Rubio, he's on a Snapchat story. So I would definitely say that the social media has completely changed how candidates are running these days. And so on another topic, when you go to vote, what do you think is the most important, the fiscal side or the social side when you're going to the polls personally?
I personally feel that a candidate's platform is more important than the person itself. I really want to see a president take office who is passionate about their platform, about the issues that not only are economic, but are moral. You know, what's right and what's wrong. And I really feel like we have a few of those candidates in the race, and I'm hoping that they start showing that and start appealing to people's need for a president who's more passionate than what we've had in the past.
So one more question. So we're obviously on a college campus here at Purdue, and traditionally college students don't turn out at the polls. Last year, or in 2012, only about 38% of 18 to 24 year olds turned out to actually vote for the presidential nomination. What do you think students, what is hindering students from turning out and voting?
I think it's the lack of events like this. I mean, getting people to focus on the questions and focus on the primaries, issues that are coming up. They're going to start talking about it with their friends. You know, it should become more of a table topic of what's going on instead of just, oh, it's time to vote. You know, we should talk about them all the time, all these issues that we have and these questions we want answered.
Great, and we're going to talk a lot more about the student vote here in a little bit with our interview with President Daniels and Mr. Heffner. Right now, I'm going to send it over to Island Sapahi, our other moderator, and she's going to she has another student that we're going to interview as well.
Hello, like Trevor Peter said, my name is Island Sapahi. I'm a senior in mass communication studying the Brian Lamb School of Communication here at Purdue University. But tonight I'm your co-host for this live viewing event of Super Tuesday. I have with us a student, her name is Emily Marsh. She is a freshman in agricultural communication with a minor in political science. Emily, thank you so much for joining us here tonight.
Thank you.
So what is your first impression of a live event like this?
I don't know. It's definitely different from the other events like this that I've been to. Typically, like, they're more in like a classroom setup. So having this and having it be more interactive is definitely really cool. And being able to be a part of something like this is definitely different from the other events on campus that I've been to.
So with a minor in political science, I'm assured that you are aware of what's going on in the political world today. Have you been keeping up with the campaign?
Yeah, definitely. Just trying to like use like our social media, obviously being a big part of our society today, just using that and just trying to keep up and whatever news you can, basically.
You brought up an excellent point with social media. So students today are getting their news from Twitter, Facebook, Snapchat. Where exactly do you get your news and how has that affected your view of the campaign today?
Definitely Snapchat is a big one, like whenever they have the little live feeds from like whenever New Hampshire and things like that. And also definitely just like Googling on CNN and things like that and just kind of doing our part as, you know, voters and being in today's society, just making sure that we're doing the research that we need to make good observations on what's going on in the campaign.
So since you've been keeping up with the campaign so closely, what are your thoughts on the candidates today?
I don't know. I've kind of been a big root for Rubio and Cruz, but I don't know. It's definitely a toss-up with everything, so.
Well, what kind of issues are you expecting or hoping to hear about from tonight?
I don't know. I feel like probably the biggest one for me would just be hearing about more about just like our economy and things like that. Obviously getting ready, like being in college, gonna be starting the adult world soon, so just obviously that's a big part of it, and just making sure that we have someone who does know what they're doing in office and things like that is definitely crucial. So
there definitely seems to be a difference in voters. Some tend to look at the more economical issues and some tend to look at more the social issues that will impact who they decide as president. So what issues are you looking at specifically that could sway your vote?
I don't know. I've always been a big one on the whole controversy over like abortion and gay marriage rights and things like those. So I don't know, just going to kind of keep an open mind and just kind of see what candidate kind of pulls more towards one or the other.
I understand. So you're a supporter of Rubio, right?
Yes.
Are you hoping that he'll win a few states today?
We'll hope so. We'll see how it goes. I don't know. It's always been a toss-up. Obviously, recently, Trump has been in the lead, but right behind him is Cruz and Rubio, so we'll see how that goes.
If you've been watching the Republican debates, you see that it's really a rivalry between Rubio and Trump. What are your thoughts on that? Are you at home rooting for Rubio, like yelling at the TV?
Yes, definitely. I don't know. Like, it would be interesting to see Trump in office, but, I mean, it wouldn't be my first choice. But I don't know. I mean, anything's possible, so we'll see.
Well, Emily, thank you so much for joining us here tonight. I'll be sure to talk to you later. We've been doing this live event here at Purdue for a while now, and I thought it'd be a good idea to take a look at what this live event has been in the past. So I'd like to introduce another student. Hi, what's your name?
My name is Ferdinand Makatenge.
And what year are you?
I'm a sophomore in the College of Technology. I'm studying computer graphics technology with a minor in women's and gender studies.
Oh, wow. So as I've been told, you were here at this event before, right?
I don't think I've been to one of these before, no.
What are your first impressions of an event like this then?
It's pretty interesting, I'd say. I mean, like, I had a class in this room once, and it's just kind of weird to see it, you know, turned into like almost a TV studio. So it's funny to see.
So you're studying computer graphics technology, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So you're really big into computers, and I would assume social media, right?
Yeah. I'm actually the marketing director for the Purdue College Democrats on campus, so I like run all their social media and stuff.
Okay, so how do you think the social media has affected the campaign this year opposed to years past?
I'm thinking it's getting a lot more young people involved, especially because, well, when you look at 2012, like, stuff like Twitter and even Snapchat hadn't, like, you know, really, like, been as mature as it had been in the past. And so I'm hoping that, you know, this year and also in the future, like, social media is a tool that definitely gets more young people out to vote and involved.
Very good point. And so what social media do you follow specifically to help you gauge your way into the campaign?
I am a big Twitter guy. Like, I just, yeah, that's where I get all my news and everything. And yeah, I mean, I also, yeah, I look at Facebook too to see what my friends are talking about. But Twitter is usually where I get like all my live news as it's breaking.
So who are you specifically rooting for in today's campaign?
I'm supporting Hillary right now. I've gone back and forth between her and Bernie over the past few months, but I think I'm in Hillary's camp now, I think.
Hillary's a big supporter of Snapchat, right?
Yeah, well, I follow both her and Bernie on Snapchat, and it's, yeah.
Well, thank you so much for joining us today. I'll be sure to talk to you later tonight and get your feedback. Right now, I'm gonna turn it over to my co-host, Trevor Peters, as he introduces tonight's discussion panel.
So, you know who I got coming out here in 6 weeks is George Shultz.
Oh, sure.
He's seen all 60 years. Sure. I mean, he's seen
All right. Well, we're here on the main set with two very distinguished guests. Again, my name is Trevor Peters. I'm a junior in the College of Liberal Arts studying mass communication and a student in the Brian Lamb School of Communication. And we're here at the Super Tuesday Watch Party, a great collaboration between the Brian Lamb School of Communication, the Department of Political Science, Pi Sigma Alpha, and the Honors College as well, here in the Hicks Underground Library, of course, on the campus of our own Purdue University. If you're on campus and you're watching at home, we encourage you to come see us. We're in room G980, and we have a good crowd of about 100, 150 people here. We'd love for you to come and join us. So I'm here with two very distinguished guests, and our first one, of course, is President Mitch Daniels, Purdue President. He became the 12th president of Purdue University in January of 2013 at the conclusion of his second term as the governor of the state of Indiana. He was elected governor in 2004 by his first bid for any elected office, and he was reelected in 2008, receiving more votes than any candidate for any public office in the state's history.
President Daniels worked for President Ronald Reagan's administration and held executive positions with the Hudson Institute and Eli Lilly and Company. And prior to becoming the governor, he became President George W. Bush's budget director. And then, of course, in March of 2015, Fortune magazine named President Daniels to its list of the top 50 world leaders in recognition of his leadership as both the governor and the president of Purdue. So please welcome President Daniels, everybody. And we also want to welcome Mr. Alexander Heffner. Mr. Heffner is a journalist and a civic educator who has reported extensively on the youth vote and the political engagement of young voters. He founded the first ever online national student newspapers covering the 2008 presidential campaign and the first year of the Obama presidency. Mr. Heffner is also the host of The Open Mind on PBS. The show is a nationally broadcasted public affairs interview program founded by his grandfather, Richard. The Open Mind first aired in 1956 and is the longest running public affairs program in the history of American public television. And Mr. Heffner's writings on the millennial vote, very fitting for where we are here at Purdue, has appeared in the Wall Street Journal, the Washington Post, the Boston Globe, USA Today, and other leading newspapers and magazines. And of course, these two gentlemen are no strangers. President Daniels actually was on the Open Mind on September 15th show of this past year. And we're very, very excited for both of them to be here with us today. So please help me in welcoming both President Daniels and Mr. Heffner. So first off, we want to welcome you, Mr. Heffner, to Purdue University. We're really excited to have you here and for you to have joined us this day on this great Super Tuesday. And we hope you've seen some Boilermaker hospitality and some people have treated you well here at Purdue.
They have indeed. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much. And so, again, this is a collaboration between the Brian Lamb School of Communication, the Department of Political Science, Pi Sigma Alpha, and the Honors College. And what we really want to talk about today is the importance of citizens in the election, and in particular, the importance of the student vote. And so we're all aware of the individual political candidates, but what we really want to focus on is the issues at hand and how that impacts Purdue and the student vote as well. So my first question I'll start with you, President Daniels. What do you feel are some of the issues that younger people seem to be more concerned with in this election?
I don't pretend to speak for them, but I speak to a lot of them, on campus and elsewhere. I think first and foremost, like Americans of all ages, they're concerned about the health of this economy. It's not performing well. It's the weakest recovery we've ever seen from a recession. You're supposed to have a very sharp snapback from a deep recession. We didn't. So you have the lowest percentage of people working since the days of the stay-at-home mom. You've had half of recent graduates either unemployed or underemployed. And so I think economic apprehension, which you see across the electorate, is very much on the minds of the young people I talk to. Now, of course, we feel different about Boilermakers.
Of course.
Because their track record in securing a great start on their careers is very strong, but we have to be concerned about that huge majority of young people mm-hmm. who weren't lucky enough to make it to Purdue or to a place like it. And right now, if they're worried, they have reason to be.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir. So, Mr. Heffner, in your studies in the millennial vote, what do you feel is truly hindering students from, or what are they interested in mm-hmm. on college campuses?
Well, my analysis in part is consistent with President Daniels insofar as the fact that what's unified the early surge of Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders was this realization that the blue-collar struggle is real. And when I was based in New Hampshire several months leading to the primary, first in the nation primary, what I got from younger voters was the Bureau of Labor Statistics, 5%, 4.9% unemployment was not an accurate reflection of a nation underemployed and unemployed in a lot of instances. But more important, different messages, they're both tackling this issue of the concentration of wealth and the fact that even if you are making an income, it's not an adequate wage. And in his own right, Donald Trump has tackled the issue of income inequality just as Senator Sanders has. So that to me is, you know, is the issue on campuses, finding employment, economic growth, and a sustainable path forward for millennials to enter the job market, and collectively fed up with a two-party establishment that has been a hindrance, like you said, as opposed to a vehicle for more progress.
Great. So then, in the 2012 election, approximately 38% of young people ages 18 to 24 turned out to vote. So then why do you think these college students are not voting? And not just that, why does that matter, President Daniels?
There's nothing new about younger people voting at a lower percentage than their elders. That's been probably true in every election we've ever seen. But as people progress in life and put down roots and have deeper stakes in society, they quite naturally take a greater interest. So I don't fault young people necessarily. I wish every single student on this campus and every young person everywhere would vote, but that's a long time phenomenon. I do think that for the moment, there's some no one is speaking persuasively to the issues Alexander just talked about, and to the apprehensions a lot of young people feel about their future and their future prospects. And until someone does persuasively, you'll probably continue to see the historic pattern of low turnout.
Mm-hmm. What do you think?
Right, persuasively and with some modicum of civility, we would hope. This has been a gutter, a cesspool of an election. It's difficult to reconcile with American values. While I mention Donald Trump in the context of winning blue-collar support, it's frustrating. The governor, the president made a comment about the role of money in politics. Let's not forget you're dealing with a billionaire who exerts significant media presence and built a reputation, whether it was a fake reputation or not, on a celebrity reality show, The Apprentice, that simulated executive decisions. As I said to a host of students today, you can decide for yourself if that's a simulation of 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. But I think tonight you'll see in real time whether there are Republicans still in the party who can coalesce around Marco Rubio or Ted Cruz. I'm sure they will in Texas, his native state. But it's a decisive night for that reason. And when you hear voices of sanity across the ideological waves calling for reasoned, thoughtful discussion and saying, you know, look, we're gonna support Hillary Clinton if you nominate Donald Trump, that is a tectonic plate potentially shifting for the Republican Party. And I think I was very eager to be here with the governor president, Mitch Daniels, who appeared on the show, and I said to him on camera and or maybe off camera, you know, he and Bill Frist, Dr. Frist, who I had on not so long before him, represented an intellectual school of the conservative movement that needs to get traction. And we will see if Rubio and Cruz can present a feasible alternative to Donald Trump. But it's not all about the blue collar angst for millennials. To go back to your initial premise, it's about bringing a set of American values that represent the diversity of the experience here at Purdue and at Notre Dame, where I was yesterday, and across the country. And millennials liked President Obama because they found him to model a kind of discourse, idealistic, even if it was, that that could unify the American electorate, even if they haven't been unified in the left-right paradigm and divide still exists.
Great. Well, we have a couple questions from Twitter that I was given, and I'd like to ask the president to answer this one first. So what is the most pressing issue of this campaign, and so what candidate messages and strategies are catching your attention?
Well, Trevor, you asked us a minute ago what the issues have been addressed. Mm-hmm. I guess I want to mention what I think has not been addressed, which is of such direct, I think, transcendent importance to young people. The debts that have been piled up in this country by the parents and grandparents of students at Purdue and elsewhere are unconscionable, and they're unpayable. They'll be defaulted on by one means or another. The question is, will it wreck the country economically and socially when it happens? And when are we going to start doing something to forestall that? And this is the old tired metaphor, the third rail of American politics. But it's an arithmetic matter. It's not an ideological matter. And in both parties, Republicans are no better, with one exception, who's not in the race anymore. None of them has gone near this. Some have actually said counterproductive things. You know, we worry a lot about student debt here at Purdue, trying to keep costs down, and we're happy to see debt of Purdue students coming down very substantially. But it never leaves my mind that the average student with debt maybe owes $30,000. Oh, that same student already owes twice that that they'll have to pay back in the future because of redeemable promises that were made to their elders. Somebody's got to talk about that issue. Otherwise, it's an incredibly unfair intergenerational inequity.
So then what do you think are some of the issues you said that that the candidates, they should be talking about, but they're not?
Yeah, that's one, two, and three to me.
Mm-hmm.
American people have been misled for a very long time. I don't fault the American people. They've been told things that aren't true. That Social Security money in there, you put it in, it's yours. No, it's a pyramid. You paid for the retirees of today, and somebody else is supposed to pay for you.
Mm-hmm.
But that the arithmetic of that is running out. Likewise for Medicare. So someone has got to begin talking about it. We're a lucky country. If we got busy, we could start addressing these things before today's young people are have a terrible unfairness inflicted on them.
Great. Well, Mr. Heffner, another question from Twitter that we want to ask you. So what is the worst case scenario for both parties tonight? What could happen? What's the worst case scenario?
I'll answer if he answers after me.
I
know. Worst case scenario. Well, look, it depends on your disposition, of course. The one thing I'd add vis-a-vis Trump and the rest of the field is, you know, he's making the argument that he can be kind of the granddaddy of the mogul who unites the various candidates and office holders who've benefited from his largesse over the years, right? And he would be doing that at the expense of maybe the core Democratic value. This is a Republican government, not an oligarchy, and it's also not the will of a totalitarian that, you know, gets to rule the day. And if he continues with the brashness that has defined his candidacy and the insults and injury and creating a climate in which, you know, violence can really sweep the day, then it's violating that basic principle, that basic promise of a more perfect union. Domestic tranquility. I don't know. Is there anything tranquil in furtherance of domestic tranquility represented by Donald Trump? I don't know. But thus far, the primary contest shows not. So, I mean, there are those establishment Republicans who will say the cataclysmic event of today in a Donald Trump sweep of most of the contests, or even, you know, a majority of them, is going to lead to a delegate math that favors him, and then they have to consider whether they're going to get the governor and Governor Bush and Governor Romney to unify around a dark horse, or to put all their eggs in the basket of Marco Rubio or Ted Cruz or John Kasich, by the way, who has a strong record on the deficit in terms of, you know, work that he's done. So that's on the Republican side. On the Democratic side, I don't know if this is such a nightmare in light of her strong victory in Nevada, but certainly if the contests are evenly split, the Democrats are going to be concerned about a drawn-out delegate fight. The superdelegates give Secretary Clinton an edge, but in the final analysis, if she doesn't win most of the contests, it's going to continue on because of the proportional way in which the numbers are divvied up among the Democratic contests. So uncertainty is one thing. I think Secretary Clinton and Senator Obama, then Senator Clinton too, they helped each other in 2008. But going beyond Super Tuesday, this cycle, there are other Tuesdays that are
comparably super potentially. You know, going beyond this Tuesday is a hard sell to party loyalists who want to unify behind a candidate. The prospect of a contested convention at one point was very possible, both for the Dems and the Republicans. And while the math actually favors a contested convention more for the Democrats, it's the Republicans who are gearing up for one.
Mm-hmm. Right. So President Daniels, in looking at all the states that we have today, which one do you think is the most consequential for both parties in today?
I got to leave that to Alexander and people who are watching more closely than I am. Let me just make a couple general observations that I just find interesting in a clinical sense. So one of them is, if people wring their hands about money in politics, have you noticed it didn't make any difference? All the money was spent on losing candidacies. I think we can all relax a little bit more about that than some people have. And this term, I don't even know who they're talking about, but establishment. If there is an establishment, it didn't count for anything either. It's been run right off the playing field on the Republican side. I guess if there is one, you can find one on the Democratic side to an extent. But for all the noise around those two subjects, they haven't figured at all into the election results so far, and odds are they won't again tonight. So in a year of one surprise after another, maybe those are two more.
Yeah. What about you? What do you think as far as which state is the most consequential heading into the evening and in the upcoming hours?
Well, into the evening, Texas and Virginia, I'd say. I mean, it's, again, depends on which states are more competitive, but if Senator Rubio can come out with a few victories, he extends his candidacy. But I really do think, despite what the governor or the president has said about the establishment, I mean, at a certain point, I wouldn't define it as establishment as much as in terms of viability, in terms of a consensus builder. We are talking about two parties, right? And just as Donald Trump is claiming that there will be crossover appeal if he's the nominee because he's got this huge turnout, apparently voters who haven't come out are really coming out of the woodwork this cycle. I think some of the public statements of Republicans just today, Speaker Ryan, Senator McConnell, demonstrate that there's something to preserve other than an establishment, right? Mm-hmm. There's something to preserve in terms of reasoned, a reasoned and reasonable identity as a...
Oh, there absolutely is. I'm just saying that whoever these people are supposed to be, they're not nearly as tough as
they're not established. Yeah, I mean,
Trevor, I'll give you this answer, not as to any one state, but I think something important to watch is just how many, Alexander just mentioned, how many people turn out. Mm-hmm. So, for instance, I looked in South Carolina, people fastened on the fact that Secretary Clinton won by a big margin,
right.
But the turnout was way down. 107,000 fewer people voted on the Democratic side in South Carolina than the last time they had a contest in 2008. Meanwhile, 363,000 more people voted in the Republican primary than voted in 2008. And it flipped. In 8, more Democrats showed up than Republicans this year by a huge margin, the other way around. So, I think that as you look across all these states, I'd pay close attention to how much enthusiasm, how much interest and support there is. It's not predictive necessarily of the general election, but it matters a lot, which if it's at all close, it matters a lot which side feels they've got somebody they're passionate about.
So then what do you think these candidates need to do to gain the enthusiasm of millennials and college students?
Well, I'd hope speak directly to them, and not in a something for nothing mode that sooner or later I think most folks will figure out it. Once again, both parties are, I won't name names, but both parties have people who are promising things that are completely irresponsible and can never be delivered. And I think, the young people on this campus are smart enough to see that, see through that.
Right.
And I think most young people in general are. I would think that eventually a candidacy that levels with young people and starts with young people,
right,
what matters most to this country is whether today's young people do have a brighter future than their parents. And what are we going to do to make that happen?
Exactly.
It won't happen at 1 or 2% economic growth, and it won't happen if we don't, if we continue to plunder the young to subsidize the old, which is what we do today.
Right. What do you think that these candidates are going to have to do to gain my generation's enthusiasm?
Well, I want to first expound on this idea of the disenfranchisement of the American voter and the record turnout that the Republicans have been experiencing, comparable to 2008 for President Obama. I'm very curious what the governor and president thinks. That's, you know,
you can save a lot of time. You just call me Mitch, you know.
Mitch, I know, I know he likes Mitch. I'm curious what Mitch thinks about that, because, you know, at the end of the day, even though we're led to believe through his public statements that Donald Trump is willing to say something racist, xenophobic, homophobic, anything bigoted to get elected, what is responsible for the huge turnout among the disenfranchised or formerly disenfranchised Republican voters? Is it, and Mitch was talking about this a bit, you know, is it a factor or function of the celebrity-driven culture that even independents and Democrats are re-registering and, you know, are attuned to politics in a way that they hadn't in the past? Or is it true that a lot of Republicans, and this is, you know, this is what people are going to say if Trump continues to spew that kind of hateful rhetoric, that there are some voters who were denied the opportunity to create a kind of regressive party that would favor positions that segregate and discriminate, and I hope that's not the case, and I hope it's new voters who are coming to the process because they believe that Donald Trump represents, or whoever they're voting for represents, progress for all Americans and not just white Americans. But that's going to be a problem, you know, if there's a public perception in the general election that the turnout was due to, you know, the invigoration of hate groups. Mm-hmm. We'll see.
Right. So another question from Twitter. I will ask you, President Daniels, first. Do you think the level of discourse in this election has been lowered by the 24-hour soundbite and social media heavy coverage this year?
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, and I'm not blaming anybody necessarily, but Alexander and I were discussing before we went on, we probably should not be surprised at the level of invective, the trivial nature of some of what is talked about, the, you know, the tweeting back and forth, little insults and all that thing. You know, I don't want to descend into old fogyism here, but we have indulged a progressive coarsening of the culture where every year something you couldn't say before is now ho-hum, mm-hmm. and something you couldn't show before is, once the shock value's over, then you can see it again. We have, wandered into a celebrity culture where people who really don't have anything important to say are given, respectful audiences, Hollywood stars, you know, they may be wonderful actors, they don't know anything, they don't know what they're talking about on public affairs, but we listen to them because they're famous. Mm-hmm. And in that situation, a Trump candidacy, for instance, or some of the discourse you're talking about, which not that long ago would have seemed utterly unthinkable, has become acceptable, or at least viewed as routine. Mm-hmm. And I don't know whether you can work your way out of that or not, but I don't think most people could fashion an argument that this is helping us get to the kind of choices and the kind of decisions we've got to make as a country to remain free and strong.
Right. Mr. Heffner, what do you think?
I concur.
Yes.
I think Mitch's work on free expression is so important because this is a reality not just among conservatives in terms of the coarsening of the discourse, but among progressives too. And you know, the analog to it is the fact that it's an insult, apparently, to say all lives matter. You know, I think that in its own way, that's dumbed down the discourse and refused a level of nuance that is mightily important in the context of public affairs, and that's not at all to diminish episodes of race-related violence where criminal justice policy has resulted in the unfair discrimination, policing, and incarceration of people of color. That's a very fair point. It's separate and apart from having divisive rhetoric that acknowledges one group taking precedence over another group. And that is, in my judgment, just as problematic as the nationalism and I think really nativism of Donald Trump.
You know, Trevor, one reason I was so eager for Alexander to come out here, and hats off to the Lamb School for right. taking advantage of his coming to do this great program, you know, he is carrying on a proud tradition of the finest in public and political discourse. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't for a minute imagine we've never had elections where the whole thing was conducted at the level of open mind. Now, I might wish that we, you know, just turn the candidates over to Alexander for a series of interviews and we'll all figure out who the right one is. Okay, so you won't have that, but we need more of the kind of conversation that he fosters. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately we've wandered, I think, an awful ways away from that. Now it's, you know, late night TV and
SNL, all these.
That's right. And, you know, this politics can be entertaining, but it isn't entertainment. Not when the country's facing the problems it is now.
Exactly. Well, we have one final question before we run out of time. And I think going back to the student vote and being on our campus, as students, what do you recommend that we do, not only to register students to vote, but also to motivate them to come out on Election Day? President Daniels.
Well, the usual exhortations, and I'll be doing it, you know, that every vote does matter, and it's a habit that you ought to start right now. You know, you own a piece of this country, and to forfeit your share mm-hmm. to somebody else because you're too darn lazy. You know, we make it awfully easy to vote these days,
yeah.
and I support these changes. I mean, it has never been so easy, and so I think there's very little excuse. And in the old saying, if you don't at least do that, please don't complain because you've given up your right to
vote early and often. Yep. that's what he's going to exhort, implore us to. I echo that. I think. You know, we haven't really taken advantage of the full transformation of the digital economy in a way that encourages not only commercial literacy and buying a product on Amazon, but one of the things that I talked to the students here about in Notre Dame yesterday is if you really believe in those principles, not only should you get out to vote, but you should create virtual mechanisms beyond Facebook and Twitter and change.org and other websites that exist now so that the virtual town hall can be vibrant. And that's really fundamentally, I think, the only way you're going to translate progress for this generation, because they're online, they're tweeting, they're Facebook posting, and that moment hasn't happened yet. So not only vote, but think about innovative ways to engage people online.
Great. Well, it's been a pleasure so far, and we really appreciate you coming
Thank
and seeing
you,
us
Trevor.
Here in West Lafayette.
Thank
we hope you,
you
enjoy your time at Purdue, and of course, President Daniels,
yeah,
it's always a pleasure
Great job.
To talk with you as well. So we have another student interview. We're going to send it over to Aylin Sapahi. She has one of our students. She's going to ask a few more questions. So, Aylin.
Are you going to go back there to her?
All right. Nice job, man.
Hi, my name is Aylin Sapahi. Thanks again, Trevor. I'm here with another student. His name is Zed. He's 13 years old. He goes to the new community school, and he's very interested in politics. So, Zed, what did you think of tonight's discussion?
I thought that I really didn't agree with Mr. Daniels when he said that he didn't know what the Republican establishment really referred to. I think that the Republican establishment refers to the rest of the Republican Party, like the senators and all that. They may have been pushed out of this election cycle, but they are not they're not completely gone. And if people who are quote-unquote not the favorites of the Republican establishment get into office, it's not clear they'll be able to accomplish anything. Like, Trump might not be able to build his 20-foot-high wall around Mexico.
So it is very possible that Trump could be the Republican primary. What would that be the future for Republicans if he is elected president?
Well, if he's elected president, we'll be in the void zone. Like, most people thought that Trump's bid was sort of like a joke, a publicity stunt. And then he actually started accumulating votes, and people said, oh, he won't win, and now he's winning. And so if he wins, it'll be like the void zone. And we really don't know what will happen. But I don't really think he'll get anything done. Like I said, like the Republican establishment doesn't agree with him. And if he does manage to get things done, it won't be major things like banning all Syrian refugees or registering Muslims. The only other registry we really have is for sex offenders.
I see. Very good points. What do you think there are any issues that the candidates are talking about that they shouldn't be talking about?
I think that they should focus less on some issues. I don't think there are really any issues they shouldn't be talking about, apart from the political jibes. But they could talk more about things like education. As a student, that's a pretty big topic for me. They could talk more about things like the debt. That's been mentioned briefly, but it hasn't really been elaborated on. It wasn't really mentioned too much in the last debate before Super Tuesday, in the Republican side at least. I don't know about the Democrat side.
So it seems like you're more on the Democratic side, right?
Yeah.
So who is your main person that you'd be rooting for on the Democrat side?
I like Hillary Clinton, mostly because I don't really agree with Bernie Sanders' position on gun control, and he has no chance of winning against anyone except for maybe Trump or Ben Carson. They might not get elected.
I see. So it seems that some voters focus more on like social issues and some focus more on economical issues. You seem very well known for what issues are being talked about. So what issues do you focus on primarily?
I think that things like the civil and social rights, those are big issues, but also obviously the crisis that's going on in the Middle East right now with ISIS and all that. That's a really big issue. And education, again, I don't think it's being talked about enough.
So you said you're only 13 years old. That means you can't vote in this election. Does that really hurt you?
No. Having a vote would be nice, but like if everyone who was 13 could vote, I don't know whether they'd do the election, right? They might not make an educated vote.
Very true. Well, thank you so much for talking with us. I'm going to throw it back over to my co-host, Trevor Peters.
All right, well, I'm here with Chris Kulesha. He is the former president of the Purdue Graduate Student Government, and he is the current senator of the So my first question, again, just how important is this day in?
It's exceptionally important. You kind of have on both sides the same thing going on, where you have an anti-establishment movement that's really trying to redefine both parties. On the Republican side, it's been a little bit more successful, of course, to the point where the individual could actually become the nominee. Whereas on the Democratic side, you're just starting to see the seeds and the beginning of what happened to the Republican Party many years ago goes for.
So then, what are your expectations in the coming hours for both parties?
I think by and large, Hillary will just solidify her position within the Democratic Party. It's going to be very interesting on the Republican side because I do think that Donald Trump will remain ahead of the other candidates. But the question is really going to become, what happens once we get to convention? Will it be a brokered convention? And then the question will become within the political parties themselves, what kind of people do we send to convention? Because of course, they only can vote for, or they only have to vote the way of their state on the first ballot in most cases. And I think that if we really see a big fracturing of the vote from state to state, it's going to just throw the Republican Party into a little bit more of, in an odd situation, trying to figure out exactly who their candidate is going to be moving forward.
So then what state do you feel today is the most important for these candidates to win over?
I think it depends who you are. honestly. If you're Ted Cruz, you have to win Texas to stay in. If you're Donald Trump, of course, you really have to start winning those southern states. But if you're John Kasich in particular, you're going to be able to make a case that you want to stay in the race if you're able to get places like Massachusetts, if you're able to get places like Vermont, and at least stay, of course, somewhere away from the bottom. Maybe you don't get exactly third towards Rubio or towards Cruz, whatever state it is, but maybe you get enough of a vote to be able to say, okay, I'm going to move on to next week into the Midwest, and I am still a viable candidate.
Do you really think that Kasich has the chance of winning a state this evening?
I don't think, unfortunately, from my view, that Kasich really has much of a chance to win tonight, but I do think if the brokered convention discussion continues on, Republicans are going to have to go for somebody who's electable. And I think that people like Kasich, Rubio, even somewhat verging on Cruz, might be viable candidates other than Donald Trump for the GOP.
So then I'll ask you what I asked the president and Mr. Heffner. Why do you think, so again, students ages 18 to 24, they really don't turn out as much when it comes, in 2012 it was 38%. What do you think we need to do as a campus to get students motivated and to be enthusiastic about voting?
I think a lot of students don't realize how much of an impact they can actually have in politics. And when they think about politics, they think it's something that's very complicated. It's only for those people who are older, that they have no way of being able to influence things. If we can overturn those attitudes and actually tell students and show them, your vote really matters. Your ability to get into the political process isn't actually that hard. I think individuals that are our age will be much more willing to get involved.
So then when you go to vote and when students go to vote, what do you think is more important to focus on, the fiscal side or the social side?
I think that it really depends on the individual, of course. I think nowadays, though, there's a economics is really on people's mind. Will I be able to get a job? Will I be able to make enough income? Will I be able to go up the economic ladder, much like my parents and my grandparents were able to do? I think on the social side of things, I think we're starting to see a little bit of a shift on some issues, but we're starting to see a shift on others. So I think it's a little bit of a wash whether or not we can really say one side is going more conservative versus liberal.
And what do you think college students are the most worried about when it comes to the social side and their candidates that they're voting for?
I think right now we're starting to see, honestly, the economic and the social issues a little bit merge, honestly, when it comes to social inequality and when it comes to whether or not individuals are going to be able to really make enough money to survive off of. But I think that a couple of things, if you think about LGBT rights, LGBT marriage, that's something that I think has really become a consensus issue among millennials. And I know that with the recent Supreme Court decision, I think that that has already been decided. But I think that the question still lingers in millennials' mind about which political party is more going to go with their particular attitudes. But it's been very interesting if you look at public polling. Our generation is much more pro-life than previous generations. And that'll be very interesting to see how those millennials break for the Republican Party in the future.
Do you think are most attractive to our college students?
I think it would be hard to say that Bernie Sanders is not very attractive. But I think if you speak to a lot of individuals on the GOP side, I think that there's a lot of individuals going for Rubio and for Kasich because they tend to be more pragmatic. And they also tend to be those that have tried going above and beyond just a simple name calling. A lot of those millennials are looking for real solutions. They're looking for real ways to get over the problems that we have today. And I don't think with many of the individuals that are in the presidential race right now that they're really doing that.
So what did you think about President Daniels and Mr. Heffner's conversation a little bit earlier? What stuck out to you and as things to focus on?
I think it was really fascinating. I really thought that President Daniels' comments about Social Security and the third rail were right on. These are math issues. We need to start getting focused on how we're going to reform Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid now so that the programs don't become insolvent later. We have a great opportunity to make sure that the budget can be fixed before the House of Cards collapses. And if we don't start talking seriously about this, I think the debt problem is really going to be a problem for our generation once we do take office in the future.
So you were a part of a group that had lunch together with Mr. Heffner today. What do you think is the most intriguing thing that he talked about today during that lunch and into tonight?
I think one of the most intriguing things that we really spoke about was the evolution of the Republican Party and what exactly is going on in the GOP, and trying to figure out where exactly is this voter frustration coming from? Why is it that somebody like Donald Trump is really able to get so much traction and become a major candidate when in previous years he probably wouldn't have been able to? And I think the conversation that we had about how, you know, we could look at history, we could look at how the libertarians or how the different factions came into play, really gives really interesting perspectives into what exactly is going on.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Chris. We really appreciate it.
Yes, thank you.
And now we're going to send it back to the main stage with Professor Josh Scacco with our special guest panel.
Good evening and welcome back. We're here on a very exciting Super Tuesday night where some of the returns have just started to come in the first four states. Before I get to those, I'd like to introduce our expert panel who is here and with me on stage. And I'm so delighted to have Dr. Jay McCann, Professor of Political Science here on my left, your right. In the center of the podium here, we have Dr. Rosalie Clausen, Professor and Head of Political Science. And on my far left, on your right, we have Dr. Robert Browning, Associate Professor of Political Science and Communication, as well as Director of the C-SPAN Archives. To give you all an update about where we are tonight, we've currently had four different poll closings in the states of Alabama, Georgia, Vermont, and Virginia. So far, what we know is that Alabama and Georgia have been called for former Secretary of State Hillary Clinton, and the state of Vermont has been called for its favorite son, Senator Bernie Sanders. On the Republican side, the state of Georgia has been called for businessman Donald Trump, while the state of Virginia as well as Vermont are too close to call at this point. So I'd like to turn it over to our panel and get a general impression of what factors do you think are at play tonight and most likely a very, very convincing win across the United States for Hillary Clinton? We'll start with Jay.
Well, I think anybody who has been forecasting this could see Hillary Clinton doing rather well tonight. The trial heat polls showed her to have a pretty decisive advantage. So I think this is really where she seals the deal.
Okay. Okay. And Rosie, what do you think are the dynamics at play in terms of thinking about Secretary Clinton's success as well?
Thank you, Josh. Happy to be here tonight. I think that Hillary has a strong organization. She has a lot of money. She has high name recognition and a long reputation associated with Secretary of State, this being in the Senate, of course, serving as First Lady, and all of those things really matter. And she has that track record of experience.
Okay. And Robert, what do you think is one of the limitations that a candidate like Bernie Sanders is facing on a night like tonight?
Well, he doesn't have the ground organization that Hillary Clinton has. So, and his appeal is not as broad in the Democratic Party as hers is. So he'll do well in Minnesota, which is a liberal state. Mm-hmm. Obviously did well in his own state, but this is not the right set of states for him to really excel tonight.
Okay, and thinking about this right set of states on the Republican side, what we know so far is that Donald Trump has been declared the winner in the state of Georgia. But what we also have is, we have, for example, in the state of Virginia, and if we can have the results pulled up on my screen here, what we actually see on the Republican side is a relatively close race between Donald Trump and between Marco Rubio at this point. So what are your thoughts in terms of why Marco Rubio might be pulling a strong last minute finish in a state like Virginia? Jay.
Oh, a huge push on behalf of Rubio over the last week or so. I mean, they've really, the sort of party establishment, as it's called, has really now come alive. Up until this point, there's been just really under the radar kind of movement to counteract Trump. But now, we've seen Rubio coming out, especially after the most recent debate. He's come out swinging. He's sort of has been more vociferous in his attacks, and he's gone against Trump in quite personal ways, just like Trump has been going after his own opponents.
Okay, so we could actually have potentially a DC effect here in terms of thinking about why some of Marco Rubio's strength at the last minute could potentially carry Virginia in his direction. Rosie, what do you think in terms of Trump in the South? So states like Alabama, obviously Georgia has been called already, but we have a number of other states in the South voting tonight, Tennessee and Texas. Where do you think Donald Trump will draw his strength tonight?
That's an interesting question. I think Trump is certainly going to do well in the South. He appeals to the white voters in the Republican Party in the South. But yet at the same time, he has shown in some other states that he can appeal to not just the very conservative voter, but also some of the moderate conservative voters. So on the conservative side, but more moderate. And he's been able to show some appeal that is much broader than anyone ever imagined. So that is a powerful effect and one of the reasons why I think he's doing so well.
And a very interesting appeal when you consider a candidate like Senator Ted Cruz from Texas. Senator Ted Cruz will be putting up a large fight tonight in the state of Texas. Polls don't close in Texas until 8 o'clock. Robert, what do you think is at play in the state of Texas when you have a candidate like Donald Trump, for example, talking to a broader swath of the Republican coalition than a candidate like Ted Cruz? How successful do you think he'll be in Texas?
It'll be close, but Trump will do better than expected. I think he's done that everywhere, and demonstrated his appeal. And Cruz has not really caught on the way Trump has. It's his own state. He came back to that state. It's really a must-win state for him, so Cruz will do well enough, but I think he'll be surprised at sort of the appeal that Trump has.
Okay. And I want to think about tonight as well for us the issue of momentum in this race. The extent to which we've had a number of contests up until this point, particularly the states of Nevada, South Carolina. Obviously, this past weekend, Secretary Clinton did very well in South Carolina, racked up 3/4 of the vote, which no one expected her to win by roughly 50 points. To what extent, and I know we can put on our research caps here, to what extent is momentum important in terms of thinking about the dynamics of how the primary happens going forward? We'll start with Robert at the end.
I'm not so sure yet it's momentum. Hillary has become a stronger candidate because of the challenge from Sanders early, and it's going to benefit her down the road. The second factor is just the combination of states. South Carolina was a great state for her. So now, if Sanders can't win and demonstrate his kind of wider appeal, then people will start closing in with Hillary Clinton, and same way that they're closing in with Donald Trump.
Okay. Rosie, do you think that after tonight, with a number of convincing victories expected, that Hillary Clinton's able to close that deal with Democratic voters?
I think that's a good question. I think Robert's absolutely right that having South Carolina there, and Clinton did so well, it's a state that really favors her. The high levels of black votes in the Democratic Party, that those black voters are going for Hillary in large numbers, especially the older black voters who turn out at high levels. And so in terms of the momentum question, the kind of way in which the states unfolded, South Carolina was really good for Hillary. But I think, you know, Bernie has some staying power in terms of he has a ton of money, and he's going, even if he does not do as well tonight as he would have liked, he's still going to be out there sending out those fundraising emails, and people are going to be, you know, chipping in their $3, their $30, their $300. and he's still going to be able to raise money. And so Bernie's going to be able to stay in it.
And what has Bernie's tagline been? He's raised an average of $27, and he says it in that very northeastern kind of thick accent,
that's Brooklyn accent. And sometimes people say Bernie doesn't have a sense of humor, but when you hear him talk about his fundraising ability, and he'll say, okay, everybody get online, send me, you know, $20, and that's my fundraiser. We're done.
Right.
And people laugh, and people love it, and they're that opposition to the power of money in politics speaks to Bernie's supporters.
Okay. And thinking about this issue as well in terms of cross kind of party appeal tonight, Jay, to what extent are Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump two sides of a very similar coin?
Boy, I'm not sure I would say that's a similar coin. Both of them are, to an extent, tapping into issues, wide concerns out there that have to do with economic opportunities or the lack of economic opportunities. Both have been portrayed as kind of a protest vehicle. I think they're really upset with the status quo. But boy, it looks like to me the differences outweigh the similarities.
Sure.
Between, I mean, however you want to look at it in terms of issue preferences, in terms of style. I wouldn't expect a whole lot of transfer. If by your question you're getting at, if Bernie Sanders ends up kind of receding, suspending his campaign or something, would any of his followers gravitate towards Trump or something like that? I don't see a whole lot of compatibility there.
Okay.
Yeah, but wouldn't you say they're both outsiders though?
Well, they're both, yeah, sort of protest in their own way. Although, let's just say, I mean, there's an outsider and then there's an outsider. I mean, Bernie Sanders is a long-term public official. He's an incumbent senator. Donald Trump is not. I mean, he's never won elective office. He's spent his career in business. If we were going to plot out inside versus outside, both would be outside of this, you know, most immediate circle. But I'd have to say Donald Trump, and for various reasons, is really much, you know, in a different kind of solar system.
And I think there's an interesting point developing here about this notion of the establishment insiders, the experience versus the outsiders. We know from a couple of exit polls tonight, for example, in Alabama, Virginia, and Vermont, that roughly 45 to 50% of Republican voters in those states are looking for an outsider, are looking for someone who does not have political experience. What's going on here? When you're thinking about an office like the president, maybe it's just me, but if I'm taking my car to a mechanic, I want to make sure that the mechanic, you know, knows what he or she is doing. So what is going on here? Jay, what do you think?
Well, ditto on the car, and you know, and pretty much everything else, doctors, dentists, whatever, okay? But in politics, and this is true way beyond just electoral politics in 2016, I mean, you can go back to my ear. You know, you can go back to Clinton, right? In the early 90s, he was a new kind of Democrat. Mm-hmm. You go back into the 80s, you know, and beyond, you know, even Jimmy Carter back in 1976, who was relatively conservative for a Democrat, but his big claim to fame was he was an outsider. He wasn't connected to any of this stuff, the stuff, the 60s and Lyndon Johnson and so on. So it's one of these things, I think, it just runs deep in American political culture, that we like to think of ourselves as innovators, we like constructive disruption in all kinds of ways, and I can't think of a public official who's ever run on the platform, elect me if you really love the way things are going, if you don't want anything to change, I'm your guy, I'm the insider guy.
So interesting to think about this. Let's kind of continue this. In what ways, then, we like to think we're in the middle of a very unique campaign. Are we, though? So, Rosie, what do you think?
Well, I think Jay's right that we have this long history of folks who are outsiders or independents, you know, getting attention. But I do think it's a new era in terms of the levels of trust that citizens have for government. And so levels of trust in government are very low. Support for Congress, support for, you know, traditional political institutions is low. And so people are angry, and people do not trust the government, the federal government especially. And so they're looking for these outsiders. So while I see it as, I think Jay's right, we've got a broader context here, but I do think there's something unique going on with the levels of trust and with the level of anger, and part of that has to do with the economic situation. And you can't blame people for being angry.
So thinking about this level of anger, it's interesting that we're talking roughly by exit poll standards, 50% of Republican voters just in the Republican exit polls tonight are angry about the way things are going. They feel that their party has betrayed them in some type of way. Long term, what does this erosion in institutional trust do for our political institutions, Robert?
Well, we also have to remember we've got all of these congressional elections and Senate elections that nobody's paying any attention to. And so we talk about the decline of party at the presidential level and the anger. What's going to be fascinating is to see how people vote in the rest of the ticket. Is it throw all the rascals out? Trump hasn't talked about that at all. Nobody's talked about that because they're focusing on their own race. But it is, I mean, we've always had this outsider. It reminds me a little bit of Perot sort of being the sort of straightened out government. Trump is a little bit more internationally oriented than domestically oriented, emphasizing the trade and immigration. But the parties still have to govern, and we still have all these congressional races, as I say, and so it's going to be fascinating to see what kind of government either one of these candidates could put together and how they're going to govern with the Congress.
Absolutely. So let's localize this for a second. When we're thinking about down ballot races, so that's a term that's thrown around that essentially means that races that are sub-presidential. Let's look at Indiana in the November election. There's not only going to be a competitive governor's race, there's also most likely going to be a competitive Senate race to replace Senator Dan Coats, who's retiring, in addition to a number of other races for the U.S. House of Representatives. When you look at a candidate like Donald Trump, what do you think happens to a candidate like, you know, does, for example, a congressman like Todd Rokita, who represents Purdue, does a Senate candidate like Todd Young or Marlon Stutzman, do they hitch themselves to the Trump bandwagon if Trump is indeed the Republican nominee? What do you think, Jay?
That's a great question. Okay.
We're doing some prediction here today, everyone.
Let me just say there are a couple of things that you know are causing the Republican candidates down the ballot to stay up late at night. Okay. The first thing is that if it is Donald Trump, he's all over the map in terms of ideology. Okay, and it's not at all clear what this might do to you. Okay, if he's meant to be the driver for turnout, it's very unpredictable. The second thing, this is a related point, is Donald Trump himself is very unpredictable. Okay, and so if you have him out, say, to a local rally on your behalf or a fundraiser, frankly, you have no idea what to expect.
You don't know
if it's
what you're
Marco Rubio or fill in the blank, there's a certain protocol, you can have expectations, there's somebody who can be handled. But to borrow a line from Robert from a moment ago, it's a little bit like what they said about Ross Perot, right? That Perot had a certain amount of quirkiness, it was very unpredictable, and nobody around him, he just couldn't retain people around him. He lost his campaign advisors, they just walked off, you know, halfway through and so on, because they just couldn't work with him, they couldn't handle him. He wouldn't be handled. And I suspect Trump would be like that, which some people find attractive, but many people in party politics, especially those candidates, would find, I think, maddening.
Yeah, so your thoughts on this?
Well, I was just going to say that I think that Republicans down ballot in Indiana and across the country get very nervous when they hear that Trump won't disavow the KKK, that he won't disavow David Duke. And so there's some Republicans in some districts that may just be perfectly fine, and they're not nervous by that. But there's a whole lot of Republicans running for office who find that highly problematic and know that they will lose votes if they're linked to that kind of ideology.
Sure. So, Robert, what do you think? Do you think Donald Trump, anchor or rocket for Republicans?
I think he will stimulate turnout. And okay. And elected politicians get nervous when that happens. They like to know the electorate. And when you have a new electorate that comes out for the presidential race, you either hope they drop off down the ballot, or that I think it's going to be very unpredictable for people. I think you're going to find them picking up a little bit on Trump's issues, running against the government, but politicians love to do that, particularly members of Congress. All the Congress is bad except them.
Right.
So I think we're going to see a little bit of that.
Interesting to think about this possibility that Trump grows the electorate for Republicans in some way. When we look at some of the states that are going to be going to be closing their polls at 8 p.m. here in a few minutes, one of those states is the state of Massachusetts, and there's actually been some really interesting talk about whether or not a Republican candidacy by Donald Trump might be competitive in states where Republicans haven't traditionally been. So the old blue-collar kind of Reagan Democrat towns, Fall River, Hull, those types of places in Massachusetts, to what extent do we think that Donald Trump could actually grow the electorate?
Well, he might grow the electorate. He won't necessarily grow the electorate in his favor. Okay? I mean, he's, as Rosie said a moment ago, it's very thinkable. I mean, imagine the commercials would write themselves, the attack ads, right? Just show Donald Trump talking about the KKK or David Duke, and you're going to be able to mobilize a lot of people who might be considered, quote, low propensity voters,
okay,
right? Because they're going to be motivated to vote against him.
Interesting.
So. Yeah, but I don't know. He's demonstrated such a Teflon characteristic so far. I mean, I said weeks ago, if you can attack the Pope and survive, you can survive anything.
You can survive in the Republican primary process. We're talking about a general election.
He's got a broad appeal. I see it.
It is shocking how broad his appeal is.
And this is something to think about. For example, most likely the Democrats will have Hillary Clinton. In a lot of ways, the Democrats will also be making history. To what extent does Hillary Clinton grow the electorate in a way that Donald Trump might not be able to? Rosie, what do you think?
I think that's a good question. I mean, the problem for Hillary is that her strongest supporters are, women who are old. Senior women
of a certain age,
and they're already going to turn out to vote at high levels, right? So she really, if she could really light the fire under younger women, more middle-aged women, it would be really helpful for her candidacy. And I'm not sure she will really be able to do that among white women.
Okay.
Black women, Latinas, Asian American women are going to turn out and vote for her. But the question is, will white women who are younger, who are middle-aged, will they turn out and vote for Hillary? And that's going to be really important.
And potentially a Trump candidacy might actually do that in terms of...
It might.
I guess we'll have to wait to see. So we are just now a few minutes away from 8 o'clock, where the polls will be closing in Massachusetts, Oklahoma, Tennessee, and the crown jewel in terms of delegates this hour will be Texas. On both sides. It promises to be a very competitive race in Texas, at least on the Republican side. We'll be right here with you throughout the night to give you the updates. We'll be back with our panel here in a few minutes.
Engineering, studying electrical engineering, and Asim is also the student on the West Lafayette Council. A few weeks ago, Fast Track Purdue Student News actually interviewed West Lafayette Mayor John Dennis in their State of the City address, and we actually talked to Mayor Dennis about Asim's new position, and we have that clip for you, and we'll see what Mayor Dennis said about Asim's position.
The, with the annex of Purdue University into the city of West Lafayette, you have some new city council members, right? Right.
Yeah, we do. Yeah,
how,
we do.
Talk a little bit about how the participation of that has happened and the new member, of, like, that's a student.
I mean, his name's Asim Jha. That's Asim Jha. And he is our student representative, and one of his major tenets is to make sure that he represents the student body as best as he can.
Sure.
Now, again, I actually had the honor to be a mediator at one of the student debates. And it was humbling to know how much, or to be exposed to how much they knew about local government. But also a lot of what they were concerned about was pretty specific to Purdue.
Sure.
And the challenge that we have is making sure that our council representative understands that there are certain things that we as local government can't get involved with Purdue. It's just not within our jurisdiction. But there's a lot of stuff that we can do to improve the quality of life for our students. And again, I'm an old guy. I don't know what's going on with the student population anymore. As
sure.
cool as I am, I know that's hard to believe. But the fact of the matter is having that direct contact with somebody who can be involved in our traffic commissions, who can be involved in our Human Relations Commission, who can be involved in some of these important bodies within local government, is just going to make our local government much more effective.
Absolutely. How long is the term for that student?
Four years. They're elected to 4 years. And that was another issue. When we were looking at having a student on council, the biggest challenge that we had was to try and find somebody that could actually make that four-year commitment. Because, I mean, in all honesty, there's a lot going on campus. There's
Absolutely.
A lot of stuff that students have to be involved with. And being a college student isn't like it was in my day. I mean, you go to class, you do your stuff, and then you go home. Students now have so much more involvement with college, so much more involvement with their university, and hopefully so much more involvement now with their city.
Awesome.
So Asim, go ahead and tell us a little bit about your position within the City Council and your roles and responsibilities.
So generally speaking, the West Lafayette City Council was recently amended because we went from a Class 3 to a Class 2 city. And so in that process, there was the annexation of Purdue's campus, which took place. And so a new district was added in the form of the 3rd District, which represents predominantly students. And so I was elected from that position. So my job is to effectively advocate for the positions of students as far as city affairs and city matters are concerned. And that's basically the extent of my responsibility, to make sure that students have a voice in how the city is run.
So then why is it important for West Lafayette to have this position on the city council?
So students tend to be a very transient population. They come in and they go, they come in and they go. And they may feel like they don't have a sense of permanence here, but they spend 4 or more years of their life in this town. So it's very important for them to have a voice in local government to make sure that the town is being adapted to their needs as well. Because even though they're temporary residents of the community, we hope that as many of them as possible can become permanent residents of the community and settle down here and make the town better than it can be.
So then how do you get students involved in elections, and how important is it for students to turn out in not just the city's elections, but in the presidential elections as well?
So I think it's very important for students to vote because they're a very underrepresented group if you look at the statistics nationally. I think something like only in the previous midterm election, 2014, I believe only something like 20-some percent of people from our area from 18 to 25 voted. And that's just absolutely abysmal. And I think we are the ones who have the most at stake in these elections because it's our future that we're thinking about. So it's very important to get younger generations more involved in the political process and turning out. And I think the best way of doing that is to show that they actually have a potential to change things. And so in that sense, meeting with students, showing them that yes, you can make a difference, even at this young of an age, is very crucial in order to develop that sort of political efficacy that you want among the constituents.
So what are the big hot topic issues right now on the West Lafayette City Council? I know you guys are working on the State Street renovation, but what is the major things that you guys are talking about in your meetings?
So generally speaking, the biggest issue has been the State Street issue, as you mentioned. We recently approved bonds to allow significant amount of funding for that, and that's actually truly an innovative project. I really credit the mayor with that. He's a true visionary in the public-private partnership. And hopefully we'll make West Lafayette considerably better. And then we also just recently approved the combined sewage overflow program to reduce the amount of waste that we're dumping into the river. And that's actually an EPA mandate. So it's good that we're moving on that now before State Street. And further, I'd say one of the councilmen has brought up the issue of redefining our city's code, because a lot of the ordinances are sort of jumbled and not necessarily organized in a very logical or sequential way. They reference books from the 70s and the 80s, which may not necessarily be as accessible now. So just streamlining and organizing that, I think hopefully that should be the next big effort.
Well, we're certainly looking forward to the beginning of the State Street project here in a couple of months. So thank you so much, Asim. We really appreciate it. We're going to send it on over to Island, who has another interview for us.
Thank you, Trevor. I'm here with Andrew. He's the president of the Graduate Student Government. Hello, Andrew. Thank you so much for talking with us.
Thank you.
My first question is, it's not very common for students of our age to go out and vote. We have actually very low voter outcome. Why do you think that is?
Well, I think students don't generally see it as impacting them, or at least that they don't think that they can have an impact. And that really couldn't be further from the truth. I mean, we have a criminal justice system desperately in need of reform. We have massive debt that's going to be impacting our generation more than any current generation. We have the government wanting to spy on our cell phone records. We have lots and lots of reasons to care and to get involved. And I definitely would encourage all young voters to get out there and actually vote.
Thank you for giving us your opinion. We're actually going to cut to a very quick video clip that illustrates more on this issue of why people our age do not go out and vote.
College students should focus on the like studying stuff, not the political stuff. You know, it's too complicated for like college students.
I think college students are really busy and they aren't as aware on the election because they're busy with their classes and everything, so they don't feel as aware enough to vote.
For college students, that's kind of like one of our last concerns.
I just feel like there's not very much information that we can base our decisions off of. Like, lack of information is most of the reasons why I'm not involved in like politics at all.
Might be a little overwhelming.
Well, I think that college students don't participate in the elections for like presidential candidates is because we're so wrapped up in trying to do everything on campus, and a lot of people don't have time to watch the news or the presidential candidates unless you're a poli-sci major or you're super interested in it. So I feel like a lot of it is time thing, because I think people are definitely opinionated enough, but they're so uneducated because you're focusing on everything else, you don't really put the time and effort into it.
And thank you. So, Andrew, my next question is, can you describe your role as president of the Graduate Student Government for us a little bit?
Sure. So our graduate student government is one senator from every department. So that's the decision-making and representative body. Our Senate itself elects its executive officers from within the Senate. And then our role is really to manage and to make sure that all of the activities of our organization go well. So my role is really kind of less making any sort of decisions as much as just sort of making sure that the train shows up on time when we host events.
And when did you become president?
Last April. So elections are actually just coming up at the end of this month.
Okay. So let's talk a little bit about the campaign, if you don't mind. What issues do you think have you been paying attention to most in the election?
So, I mean, as young people, sort of what I mentioned before, the debt, job prospects, that's obviously very important to college students graduating, and then, well, if you don't have a job, that's very bad. If you have mountains of student loan debt, that's also very bad. But additionally, issues like criminal justice reform, issues like NSA spying on cell phone records, issues like marijuana legalization or that sort of thing, all of those are issues important to young people, and quite frankly, I don't think that they're addressed by any of the candidates, at least not addressed, all of them aren't addressed by any of the candidates still in the race.
And who are you rooting for in the campaign?
Who am I rooting for? I would consider myself libertarian-ish. I actually went to Iowa for 10 days before the Iowa caucus to work for Rand Paul's campaign. And so with him dropping out, we didn't get the results we wanted, obviously. With him dropping off, for someone like me who would describe themselves as libertarian-ish, there isn't really a candidate out there. So I'm really just rooting against Donald Trump.
There was a episode in The Daily Show where they called him Donald Trump. Are you aware of that?
Yes, I really, really enjoyed that episode. It's really sad. There is no way in which Donald Trump is a conservative in any way, shape, or form, and he doesn't go out there and say anything at all. So it's a sad state for the Republican Party. It's a sad state for our national politics, and really worries me a lot about who are these people who are coming out and voting for Donald Trump. Yeah.
They say that one of the reasons that Donald Trump is so popular is because the fact that voters dislike him so much, we keep talking about him. Do you think that that's really been helping out his campaign?
I think it probably does, but I think it's very sad that all you have to do is talk about how ridiculous someone is, and apparently that gets them better support. It should be about the ideas, and that's not what's happening right now.
All right, well, thank you so much for talking with us, Andrew. It's a real pleasure. I'm going to turn it over back to our panel to discuss more about Super Tuesday. Thank you.
And we're back tonight. We've had additional poll closings in...
Thank you.
And we're back right now, and we've just had one of those malfunctioning camera cue issues, as usually happens. We're back with our panel, Dr. Jay McCann, Dr. Rosie Clausen, and Dr. Robert Browning. It is now a few minutes after 8 o'clock, and what we know is that Hillary Clinton's sweep tonight continues in the South. She has won the states of Tennessee, Alabama, Georgia, and Virginia. And I want us to focus some time. In the last segment, we focused a good bit on the Republican frontrunner. But I want to focus now in thinking about the dynamics that are really powering Hillary Clinton. In many ways, she has been very successful tonight in states that were in the Obama coalition in the 2008 primary. So what flipped the script from 2008? What do you think, Jay?
Well, I think she's a better candidate this time around, for starters. She's better organized. You know, and Bernie Sanders, I think, you know, you got to give him credit as well. But what Hillary has done is pull in some big resources. She's come across, you know, she's sewn up a lot of the party folks in all these different states. I think her debate performances this time around have been strikingly better than in years past. So I think, obviously this is her cycle to go on it. I think she's got more confidence coming out of the Obama White House, right? She just has a much deeper record.
Okay. And one of the things that many political scientists have talked about now for the past couple of decades is the realignment of the South from the Democratic Party, really, in the 1950s and 60s towards the Republican Party. So really, the only Democrats now that are left in the South are probably some of the more traditional Democrats in the party. Would you agree with that, Rosie?
Right. So yeah, Democrats in the South are going to be African Americans.
Okay.
And liberal whites.
Okay.
You're absolutely right. There has been a sea change in the South, and conservative Democrats, a lot of white Democrats, flipped and went to the Republican Party. And so it's a very different electorate than it was 20 years ago, 30 years ago. And so I think Clinton, she has been seen as loyal to Obama, and that helps her bring in black voters. And of course, her husband has a long history with black voters of being supportive of him. And not uniformly. There are, blacks are not a monolithic group. There are differences. But certainly she has that history and that experience that allowed her to draw heavily on the black vote. And Bernie just doesn't, despite the fact that he has issue positions that would be very interesting to a lot of African American voters. But he hasn't been able to effectively reach out in that way. Maybe among younger black voters, but not so much among the older generations.
And just as a point of reference, when we're talking about some of these states tonight, Tennessee, Alabama, Georgia, Virginia, we're talking these electorates, these Democratic electorates are, in some cases, 50% African American, and that is powering Hillary Clinton forward tonight. Why do you think, Robert, a candidate like Bernie Sanders hasn't been able to break through among traditional elements of the Democratic coalition that form really the bedrock of what it takes for Democrats to win nationwide?
Well, there's a certain loyalty, as Rosie says, to the Clintons that she's building on. His message is a lot narrower. Its appeal is not as broad as people, as African Americans have gravitated more to the Clinton message and to the Clinton Obama record, and Bernie's bringing big crowds of students and young people, but they're not the voters all the time, and they're not the voters in the South. So it's just not the right states for him to do well in, but she's going to do well enough tonight that she puts a sort of a doubt about whether he can go the distance.
And I think one of the interesting things to think about in terms of the Democratic primary is the influence of now a vacancy on the Supreme Court. So we've actually had a question come in on Twitter of how will the Supreme Court debate shape the election moving forward? Obviously a very contentious process breaking out with Senate Republicans and President Obama, but to what extent might this actually be bleeding over into the Democratic primary race? What do you think, Jay?
I think if anything, it solidifies this notion of electability.
Okay.
And you want, the stakes are higher, right? It matters who you're going to get as president. And there's a good amount of evidence in political science research to say that the people who turn out in primaries and caucuses do think to an extent about electability. But now, in particular, the stakes get a little more real. And I think to the extent that you think about electability as opposed to ideological fit or style or other things, I think that advantages Hillary Clinton.
Okay. And thinking about this notion of electability, turning kind of toward the Republican side, there's actually been a lot of very interesting recent research in political science suggesting that Republicans and Democrats think about this issue differently. That Republicans are much more, at least modern Republicans, much more interested in kind of this ideological purity, which in some ways might help a candidate like Ted Cruz potentially be successful. Do you think that electability still matters across the board for both Democrats and Republicans? Rosie, what do you think?
I mean, I do think it's important for a lot of voters. That's a hard question, I think. Democrats are definitely seeing Hillary as an experienced candidate, someone who can do the job from day one. And they have questions, Sanders just isn't as well known. I think on the Republican side, this anger, the electability issue suggests that you want somebody who has experience, who can do the job well right away. But the angry Republicans are saying, who cares? Those guys in office have really screwed things up. They're not doing a good job. So why should we put somebody in there who is electable in that sense? Why not go outside and put somebody in there like Trump, who may not have any political experience at all, but who's willing to shake things up?
Right. So thinking about, some of these outsider candidates, and there are a number on the Republican side in addition to the front runner. You have Ben Carson, for example. You have, in some ways, Ted Cruz framing himself as an outsider. To what extent is a candidate like Ted Cruz or a Ben Carson trying to play on this notion of anger, but also flip the script and say that you sent the political experts, and they failed you? So send someone who doesn't have this type of background. Robert, what kind of appeal does that have?
Well, remember, we're in primaries, and primaries appeal more to the extreme voters than the general election. Traditionally, we see the candidates come back to the center in the general election. I don't know, we'll certainly see that with, I would think we would see it with Hillary. I don't think we'll see it with Trump. I think he'll stay to his message.
Okay.
I think he'll act more presidential. I think he'll kind of calm down his message a little bit after he gets past this set of primaries and appeal differently in the general election.
Okay, and that's going to be our next topic when we return to you. We're gonna send it back over to Trevor to talk with Dr. Mary Fran Mattson from Communication.
Well, I'm here with Dr. Mary Fran Mattson, professor and head of the Brian Lamb School of Communication here at Purdue. And we have a few questions we want to ask you today, Dr. Mattson. So the first one, she's really done a great job of help organizing this event. So how important is it for Purdue to have this kind of event where students can really gain knowledge on what's going on
in the primaries, and how critical is it for students to attend an event and Purdue to put on an event like this?
I do think it's crucial. I think it's a great opportunity for us to showcase what we can do when we get together as the Honors College and the Department of Political Science and the Brian Lamb School of Communication to bring it together, students, our community, to, you know, really kind of focus on and showcase our interests in what's going on outside of Purdue University. So this gives us the opportunity to do that and, you know, just allow students to show their interest in what's going on.
Well, great. So what did you think of President Daniels and Mr. Heffner's speech a panel a little bit earlier? What were some key things that you pulled out of their panel?
I thought it was interesting to listen to their different perspectives on what the current issues are, why Super Tuesday is important, the involvement of students in those issues and in what's going on, kind of even where Purdue sits, even if we're not involved necessarily in Super Tuesday directly in voting, but why what's going on Super Tuesday is important to Purdue.
Great. And then one final question I want to ask. So how important is the woman vote in this year's election and heading into the results later this evening and ultimately towards the presidential race?
I think for women to get out and vote is always important. I think not just because we have a female in the election, but because there's a variety of issues that are important to women, and so we have to get out and vote on those issues for those candidates that we support. So I think that's always important, but this year, you know, right now it's happening, so it's important to do that as well.
Well, thank you so much for all you've done for this event, and we hope maybe we can have something like this again in the future. It was a real pleasure. Thank you so much. So we're also here with Joanne Evers. She is a representative from the League of Women Voters of Greater Lafayette. So, Joanne, first off, would you just mind telling us a little bit about the League of Women Voters and what your responsibilities are here in the Lafayette community?
Well, I would be happy to do that. The League of Women Voters is a nonpartisan, all-volunteer political organization. And we've been around for 96 years. We came out of the women's suffrage movement of 1920 when we finally got the right to vote. So we are here tonight on the invitation from Sigma Alpha. I wanted to get the names right. And we are here to register voters, if anyone here needs to register to vote or change an address or just provide some information for any of the students or faculty or staff who may be here tonight. That is our goal, to educate and to advocate for good public policy. And we're here tonight to do that.
Well, great. So if students are watching at home or hearing this broadcast and they're not here today, where can they go to vote or register to vote, and how can you guys assist them?
Well, certainly they could contact us through our website, leaguelafayette.org, and we would get back to them and give them specific information. But if there are students who are Indiana residents that have an Indiana driver's license, they may go online and register online to vote in Indiana. And that's indianavoters.com. And they just need a driver's license. Otherwise, there are paper forms also on that same site, indianavoters.com, that they can print, complete, and mail into their county election board. So it's very simple to register to vote. What's important to remember is you can't vote unless you're registered. So students have to get out there and get themselves registered. And we know you have many, many students here at Purdue out of Indiana. They come in from other states. So it's a matter of choosing to register in their home state or choosing to register here. One way or the other, they can register to vote and then get out there on May 3rd, which is our primary. And there will be a polling location at the Union. So it's very convenient for them to cast a ballot on May 3rd and also November 8th when our general election comes around.
Well, great. Thank you so much, Joanne. We really appreciate you guys being here tonight and for everything you just told us. So we're going to go ahead and send it on over to Island with another student.
I'm here with Sean. He's a senior in political science here at Purdue University. Sean, thank you so much for talking with us. I see that you have an ID tag, which means you have a role here tonight. What is that role?
So my role here has been feeding the panelists content on updates on the states as the results start coming in to make sure they stay up to date on the info.
So since you've been looking at the data all night, is there a specific state that we're focusing our attention on right now?
I think the state that needs to be paying attention to is Virginia for the GOP, because as of right now, Trump's still leading Virginia, but only in the western half of the state results have really come in. The bigger areas, more populous areas, still haven't came in yet, and those are starting to come in, with Rubio having a pretty big margin of victory there, so it'll be interesting to see if that pays off for Rubio.
So being a political science student here at Purdue, have you ever been able to participate in something like this live?
Not on a live stream, but in 2014 we had a similar election watch party for the midterms that our organization Pi Sigma Alpha ran.
And how was that experience different from this experience?
Quite a bit, actually. Before, we didn't have the camera crew set up and the stage with panelists. Before, it was kind of more just like everyone walking around talking to each other, which we kind of still have going here, but we didn't have panelists speaking about the results as they come in.
Okay, so let's get right down to the campaign. So as a student, what are your main concerns in the campaign?
My two main concerns may seem a little bit odd, but the environment and the VA reform, so Veterans Affairs.
Okay, and which candidate do you think has really been pushing those efforts forward?
Well, for the environment, I would have said Martin O'Malley a few weeks ago in Iowa when I personally got to meet him. He was the only candidate I felt that really addressed those issues, but now it has basically fallen to Bernie Sanders. For VA reform, all the candidates have their own sort of reform for it, still kind of sorting through their exact economic plans, how they impact the VA to kind of make a better determination on who is best for the veterans.
I see. And so I know that I pulled you away from your job, and I'm so sorry about that. But what has there been any trends in the results that we've been receiving tonight?
Based on the early results of the states that various sites have been projecting to win, no big shockers on who's won those states. The states that everyone thought Trump would win, he's won. The states that Clinton was expected to win, she's won. And Bernie Sanders, of course, won Vermont. So right now there's been no surprises. Virginia might be kind of the first surprise if it goes towards Rubio, not Trump. And we still got a few more states to go in the evening, though.
Okay, and would you say you are or are not a supporter of Trump?
Oh, hell no, not a Trump supporter. I will make that clear.
Did you see on the Daily Show that they referred to him as Drumpf?
Yes.
And what are your thoughts on that?
I think it's actually quite perfect. I mean, the thing with Trump is that he's been touching on a lot of nerves that a lot of people in America who haven't come out to vote before, that are angry with the government, he's hit a nerve with them that they have felt a connection to with. So he's done a really great job there connecting to those people. But I think when you get past that base of people and go to more, it's people that aren't really concerned about anger and actually looking for true reform. And you look at his actual policies, he doesn't have any true policies outside of saying, I'm going to build a wall with Mexico and make Mexico pay for it. Like, that's the only thing he's promoted. In the last GOP debate, you saw Rubio Cruz, amongst others, actually bring about poking holes that Trump has no real policies.
So since you've actually been looking at the data for the Super Tuesday evening, do you think that Trump has had a leg up in the competition? Do you think that he will actually come out on top for Super Tuesday?
Overall, most likely he'll come out on top, just based on a lot of these states that he's been leading in the exit polls and projections and how the results have been going so far. It'll be interesting as we go forward, though, if he doesn't do as well as he did on Super Tuesday because of this past GOP debate.
And would you say you lean more Democrat? Since you dislike Trump so much, I'm going to assume that you're Democrat. How have the Democrat side been holding up in the Super Tuesday event?
I wouldn't say I'm a Democrat. I lean independent, and then I just go wherever candidate actually hits issues I care about. But for the Democrats in this election, I think it's all about the youth vote, really, because if the youth have the biggest turnout in a state, more likely Bernie Sanders is going to win that state. And so if the youth don't come out in a higher droves and say 45 and up, then Clinton should win those states, just based on what we've seen in the very early states like Iowa, New Hampshire. So it's really up to the youth in this election for the Democrats to determine who wins.
So you're saying that it's a big focus on the millennial vote?
Yes.
And the millennials, they've been focusing more, they get like their news from the political side from their social media. Do you think that social media has been helping Bernie Sanders in his campaign?
I think it's really helped drive home Bernie Sanders' points, because I mean, a lot of my friends on Facebook share these like Bernie Sanders memes to get people talking about him. And I think there's just a lot of support with what Bernie's message is amongst youth, and it really spreads on the social media platforms a lot more than, say, what Clinton's messages do.
And since we're talking about millennials, there's been data that suggests that millennials are the group that doesn't vote, they don't really vote that much. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, 2016 is going to be the first election where you have the majority of millennials voting for the first time. 2008 was the start of that group, so it's kind of early to determine. I think the reason why you don't see millennials come out, though, is because of the fact that candidates don't appeal to the millennial generation in terms of their policies. But it's a reverse effect as well, because candidates know millennials don't vote, young people don't vote, so why are they going to promote policies for the youth when they know that's not a voting base?
Well, thank you. That's all the time we have. Thank you so much for speaking with us. I'm going to throw it back over to our panel tonight. Thank you.
Good evening, and we're back on a very exciting Super Tuesday night. It is now 8:30 p.m., and the polls are closing in Arkansas, where we can anticipate that Hillary Clinton is probably going to do very well based on not only how she did 8 years ago, but also because she's former First Lady of Arkansas, because her husband was governor as well. So the Clinton roots run very deep in Arkansas. But we're also monitoring a couple of other very interesting races. Looks like Donald Trump has won 4 contests so far, is leading in another 3. Hillary Clinton has also won 4 contests so far. And Bernie Sanders is actually leading in a couple of contests right now, Massachusetts being one of them as well. So I want to ask the panel, in terms of thinking about, you know, where do we go going forward in terms of the general election? Let's say, you know, scenario continues in terms of trend that Republicans nominate Donald Trump. To what extent does he do well in some potential Democratic strongholds that we might not have been competitive in the past couple elections, Massachusetts, Illinois, Pennsylvania? Robert, what do you think?
Wherever there's white voters, he'll do well.
Okay, so you want to elaborate on that a little bit?
No, he is polling people out who feel, as his slogan says, "Make America Great Again," that feel that America, that the Obama administration hasn't done enough for America, and the deals that have been made, the Iran deal, the immigration issue, that he has a great appeal there to a wide section of the voters, and I think he will do well in areas that we hadn't seen Republicans do well in before.
Okay, so thinking about, for example, maybe a state like Indiana or Illinois, which has been Indiana, for example, has been pretty consistently Republican, 2008 being that one anomaly. To what extent might a candidate like Hillary Clinton potentially play in a state like Illinois or Indiana? What do you think, Rosie?
I think that's a good question. Now, before I answer, I want to introduce my son, Zoe Clausen Smith. He's watched lots of the debates with me and has been very interested in the election returns. And the other night, we actually watched election returns rather than watching the Purdue-IU basketball game.
Wow.
So that's how serious we are in our household. And we're basketball fans, so, you know, we're still very serious about our election.
And this was the South Carolina returns?
Yes. I think that Trump will appeal to white voters. I think that will put Hillary in a pickle in Indiana and in lots of other states. And so Jay mentioned earlier that he thought people would turn out to vote against Trump. And I do think that's true. But I also think that Trump will turn people out in record numbers, as he has in these primaries, and that will be dangerous for the Democrats, because he's going to pull some of those white, especially male voters, over to the Republican Party.
Sure. So, Jay, thinking about maybe some keys to the Democratic, you know, lock in the Electoral College, Illinois, Michigan, Pennsylvania, in many ways, parts of these states very blue-collar. To what extent does Donald Trump make these states competitive?
Well, that's a tough one to say. That's a great question. It's tough to say. I guess I wouldn't go out on a limb so much as to say wherever there are white voters, there are the Trump voters. If you look at the racial breakdown in earlier elections, even without Trump, you still saw this racial divide. So the question is, how much extra is Trump going to add to that, and how much of that would be offset by the counter-mobilization effect? Those are unknowable, but it's easy to imagine that Florida, for instance, that is one of these important swing states. Boy, it'd be hard for Trump to pull them in. And some, you know, you just think the strategic environment, right, may not necessarily go in Trump's favor. The second point that's worth noting, I think, when we think about the next steps, is that, okay, if present trends continue, you might say, well, Trump is going to have some natural advantages. But I can think of two reasons why present trends aren't going to continue. One is that the Hillary Clinton campaign is already preparing her messaging campaign, right, against Donald Trump, assuming that he's going to be the guy. So she, in other words, is not going to be asleep at the switch the way Jeb Bush was last summer. Okay. The second thing, and this is interesting, we haven't talked about this yet, and it's all very hypothetical, but if it turns out, if Trump runs the table, or most of the table tonight, and it looks like he's a foregone, it's a foregone conclusion to be the nominee, there is still time for a third person to enter.
Absolutely.
Okay, the earliest state deadlines to get on the ballot aren't until June-ish, thereabouts, and you have until August. Some states have rather late deadlines, so it's thinkable that not Cruz, but somebody like Cruz, okay, somebody on the right, an evangelical Christian candidate might pop up and decide to run as an independent or get the nomination from some minor party, and it's easy to imagine other scenarios. So these are the things that, you know, if you have a political science degree, right, you can kind of speculate about all these different, who knows, plausible, implausible.
Or for Purdue students who would be interested in a minor. I'm sure the political science department, as well as, you know, the Brian Lamb School of Communication would love to have you for a minor.
That's right.
A little bit of a shameless plug moment for us.
Let's all plug in. Everybody watching this, study more liberal arts.
Yeah, exactly. We'll just make a plug for the College of Liberal Arts in general in terms of these things. I want to kind of come back now to thinking about some of these closer races tonight. And if we can we get Virginia pulled up on the screen here? Because I think something very interesting is happening in Virginia. So Marco Rubio made a very late play for the state of Virginia in terms of its delegates. And what you actually see is Virginia up on the screen. What you actually see is a very close contest right now. So we have roughly 70% of the vote in Virginia. And the key thing to understand here is it's not necessarily about what amount a certain candidate's up right now. It's where are votes left in terms of where they have yet to come in. And what we're seeing on here is that a number of votes in Northern Virginia, particularly Arlington, Fairfax County, where Marco Rubio made a late play, have yet to come in. And early returns suggest that he's leading in those areas. So kind of thinking about these results, Texas still also too early. Arkansas still too early. Oklahoma still too early on the Republican side. We just got word that Hillary Clinton did indeed win did win on the Democratic side in Arkansas. But thinking about what happens when Donald Trump maybe doesn't win one of these states, or doesn't win two of these states, or one of these candidates overperforms expectations. What do you think happens to Trump momentum in this circumstance, Robert?
Oh, I think it's not going to be slowed. Virginia, you know, we've got the D.C. suburbs where Rubio's going to have more moderate appeal, and that's going to be an exception tonight.
Okay.
I don't see Trump being slowed down at all.
Okay. Rosie, what do you think in terms of some of these other states, maybe like Texas?
Yeah.
The largest delegate prize, what if Donald Trump doesn't win it?
Right. Well, I think we'll have to wait and see what happens. But I do think that, Rubio or Cruz, probably Rubio, is still going to get attention, and people are going to be coalescing around him as the anti-Trump candidate.
Mm-hmm.
And so these establishment Republicans that we've referred to several times tonight, those folks are going to be looking for somebody besides Donald Trump and besides Cruz.
Sure.
And Rubio is probably their person. And so if he can do well in Virginia, he doesn't have to win it. If he can just do well, then that still gives him an argument to keep going.
Sure. And I want to think about this for a second. To what extent are wins maybe not necessarily wins tonight? So one of the things we haven't talked about is how these delegates are going to go to the national conventions. The Republicans have a very kind of unique process in terms of thinking about delegates tonight. But suppose Donald Trump wins the overwhelming majority of these contests.
is it possible that delegate-wise, Ted Cruz, Marco Rubio could still be competitive for the hunt for the nomination tonight, Jay?
Yeah. I think, actually, the longer we see all these candidates in, presumably, the more delegates you're depriving Trump of. So it's entirely possible that you can go into the convention and no one's going to get the numeric pledge.
Okay.
And that would indeed be interesting.
But Jay, isn't tonight the last night for proportional representation in the Republican Party?
Yeah, from here on out.
Right, it'll be winner take all. So that will really help the front runner.
That's the way they designed it.
Yeah. So momentum will be very important from here on out. The next big contest being Florida. It would be a surprise if Marco Rubio doesn't stay in, at least to compete in his home state. Additionally, John Kasich in Ohio as well. I think we'll know more in terms of how the state of the Republican race plays out in a couple of weeks. So I want to turn it back on over to Trevor Peters, who is going to be interviewing one of the students here at the watch party tonight.
Well, thank you, Professor Skatko. I'm here with Claire Lee, a sophomore studying political science and economics, and she's also on the Honors College Leadership Council. And so, Claire, a couple things I want to ask you. First off, would you go ahead and let us know a little bit about the Honors College Leadership Council and exactly how the Honors College has influence and what they've done in this event that we put on today?
So the Honors Leadership Council is a group of students from every college who meet regularly every week to not only discuss issues going on with Honors College students and bring them to the light of the dean, but also plan events like this night and join in conjuncture to build those leadership skills and those different civic skills within the Honors College students.
So what are your thoughts on the event so far? Are you impressed with how the turnout and the interviews from our special guests and President Daniels and Mr. Heffner?
It has been amazing. I think being able to see Alexander Heffner and President Daniels up speaking to you not too long ago, and then also the panel of professors we just heard from, it's really nice to hear those different perspectives and hear from people who don't always come to Purdue. And so especially on Super Tuesday, a day that I've been looking forward to and have been talking about in many of my classes for the last few weeks, to have these big name figures here to talk about the big issues has been really nice.
So what specific information that President Daniels and Mr. Heffner talked about during their panel really stood out to you and made an impact on you?
I think just thinking in general about the policies talking about in this election, and also just how this election is very different from those beforehand. I think it's really interesting, especially I actually had Mr. Heffner in my class earlier, and to hear him talk about the young vote and how much of an influence that played in 2008, but also coming into this year and how that might change things once again.
So what do you think the Honors College and students in political science and even in communication, what do we need to do in order to motivate our peers to turn out and to vote when it comes to Indiana's turn?
I think one really important thing is just start that discussion. I've been amazed in a lot of my classes, my peers, you know, we're talking about these things. It's so cool to come to Purdue and see people willing to discuss the big issues and not just, well, you know, Donald Trump said this, Hillary Clinton said this. And so to incite that discussion even more and have that all over campus, I think that gets people excited about what's coming up and will increase that voter turnout come May.
So going forward in this kind of event, how or what do you think we could do? Do you think this is an event that we could continue on in future years, future Super Tuesdays? And how important is this kind of event for students to become knowledgeable about what's going on in our country?
Well, I'm very excited about this event and its future. I think that it's really integral to getting people knowledgeable. With college students, it's very easy to, you know, get caught up in that test, get caught up in that project, and forget that there are actually very important events going on outside of our dorm rooms and our apartments. And so this event, and hopefully in the future, it will grow even further to just, you know, go spread through all of campus. But it really spreads that knowledge and lets people think about things and the real policies and just take a few hours to take a step back and think about how these candidates and their policies are going to not only affect our lives here in college, but also once we get out.
So one final question for you, Claire. As we've seen some of the results in the polls come in, what are you expecting as the night continues to progress, and what are you hoping for?
So I guess in terms of the polls coming in, it has been a little bit surprising already just to see how large the margins are, especially on the Republican side. I thought it'd be a little bit closer. It's not been so far, but, you know, still very early in the night. I think as we go through the night, my hope, of course, is that candidates, former Secretary of State Clinton will, you know, hopefully pull in quite a few states, quite a few delegates. But also, I'm really interested to see how the Republican situation pans out. Like, a lot of students were a little worried about how Donald Trump is going to play. So maybe some of those other candidates rising to the occasion and garnering a few more votes, hopefully.
Well, great. Well, thank you so much, Claire, for taking a moment to chat with us. We're going to send it over to Island with another very special interview. Island, what do you got for us?
Hi, Trevor. I'm here with Ruth. She is 11 years old. Hi, Ruth. Thank you for talking to me.
Hello.
So you're only 11 years old, which means you can't vote in this election. But if you were, let's say you were 18 years old, who would you vote for?
I would vote for Secretary Clinton.
Secretary Clinton, and why is that?
Because I believe that she can do great things to America.
And what do you think those great things are? What do you think that Hillary Clinton, if she were president, what do you think she would be able to do?
I think she can improve Obamacare.
You think she can improve Obamacare? And how do you think she can improve Obamacare?
By making it so that more percent of people have health care.
So one of your main concerns for the campaign is health care, right?
Yes.
And why do you think health care is so important?
Because everybody needs to be able to go to the doctor when they get sick.
Exactly. Everyone should get that flu shot, right?
Uh-huh.
So apart from healthcare, what other issues are you most concerned about?
Well, I'm concerned about illegal immigrants from Mexico.
About illegal immigrations from Mexico.
Uh-huh.
And who do you think is the best person that could handle that issue?
I also think Hillary Clinton could handle that issue.
You don't believe in Trump's wall?
No.
So you don't think that Trump's wall over Mexico is really going to help with immigration? You think that Hillary Clinton can do the job?
Yes, a physical wall won't really make a big deal. I think more like a law wall.
So what do you think that Hillary can do to help with that situation?
I think she should just get everyone that's living here a permit so that they can live here the way they were living before, except slightly happier.
I think that's a good option. So you're a fan of Hillary, and it seems like you're not a big fan of Trump. Why is that?
Well, everyone in my class views him as a practical joke to be insulted and laughed at.
Your classroom makes jokes of Donald Trump?
Yes.
Do you have a joke that you can tell us, or an instance of when they made fun of Donald Trump?
Well, during the ugly sweater party on Christmas, one of the sixth graders put a picture of Donald Trump on her sweater, and she won the ugly sweater contest.
She won the ugly sweater contest by putting a picture of Donald Trump on her sweater?
Uh-huh.
Did you vote for her to have the ugly sweater?
Yeah.
That is hilarious. So what other reasons do you not like Donald Trump other than his ridiculous solution to immigration?
Well, because he said that he wanted to bomb ISIS's families, which is completely ridiculous.
You think that is completely ridiculous?
The military's going to refuse.
Really?
Uh-huh.
So, I'm going to assume that you think Hillary Clinton can do a better job than Donald Trump when dealing with ISIS.
Yes.
And why do you think that?
Because from what I've seen, Hillary Clinton is actually reasonable, and she won't make complete war where they're going to bomb us, because that's not what I want.
And what do you want? What do you hope to see in the next... whoever wins this campaign, what do you hope that they do to deal with ISIS?
I hope they can calm down and like end their reign of terror.
Very, very, I completely understand that. So you are 11 years old, but you seem to know a lot about politics. Is education an issue that you are concerned with?
Yes, I think education is important because the kids need to be able to know what they're doing if they want to go out and get a job.
Do you think it would be a good idea if the voting age was lowered to 11?
Yes, I think that would be a very good idea.
You think so? Do you think other 11-year-olds are as knowledgeable of politics as you are?
Probably.
You think so?
Yes, because everyone in my class knows a whole lot about Donald Trump so that they can criticize him.
Very, very true. It seems that Donald Trump is not very popular. Well, Ruth, thank you so much for talking with us. I really appreciated it. I'm going to throw it back over to my co-host, Trevor Peters, for another special interview.
All right. Well, I am also here with Giovanni Malloy. He is a junior in industrial engineering, and he's also on the Honors College Leadership Board. And he is also a member of Purdue Student Government as the engineering representative. So my first question for you, Giovanni, what do you do on PSG on their board, and what are the pressing issues that you guys are discussing currently in your meetings?
Yeah, so I'm a senator for the College of Engineering, which means I go in and I represent my college in issues that stem from kind of internal PSG things all the way to recommendations at the state and national level on policy. And so it's really great. I get the opportunity to represent my fellow constituents and my fellow engineers and really try to interact with them on a personal level. And I've gotten to meet a lot of people just because I've really strived to be transparent in all that I do.
Well, great. So what are the specific things that PSG is looking forward to in the rest of the semester and into next year?
Sure. So something that we did recently that's really exciting was, if you're familiar with the Article 5 Convention of States, we recently passed a bill supporting that at the state level. And then my friend and my fellow Senator Ross Smith and I, we went down to the State House and lobbied in support of that bill in front of the Judiciary Committee. And it just passed the House last night, so that was really exciting. And then kind of more at home, we've been focusing a lot on diversity issues, making sure that students feel comfortable on campus and that PSG is really a mouthpiece for inclusion.
Well, great. That's awesome. So what are you looking forward to as the night progresses and as the polls come in? What are your opinions and what do you hope ends up happening?
Sure. So I'm really hoping that someone with a positive message, a more positive message, can break through in the Republican race especially. So I'm really holding out for folks like Rubio and Kasich, if possible. I think the folks who are leading right now, Donald Trump, I think he's a divisive figure, and I think if he does win the nomination, I think he'd shake up the party dynamic quite a bit. I know there's a senator from Nebraska who recently came out and said, if Donald Trump is our nominee, I will not support him, and he might even leave the GOP. So it'd be really interesting, but I'm not sure if, you know, the state that our country's in, I'm not sure if that's what we want and what we need at the moment.
What policies do you think, Rubio, you mentioned, what do you think he has an advantage to Donald Trump, and how do you think he could overtake the primary from Donald Trump?
Sure. So pretty much on every policy issue, I think Rubio has a more detailed plan than Donald Trump. Generally more realistic plans than Donald Trump. And he has a positive message. Like, he's always talking about a new American century. And he's really the voice of millennials, I think, in the Republican Party right now, especially after Rand Paul dropped out of the race. So I think, in particular, if you look at foreign policy issues, I think he has a much more realistic approach in dealing with the intricacies of different cultures and being the figurehead and the main ambassador, if you will, for the United States. And I think he would make a much more sound commander-in-chief of our military. You know, Trump has been out there basically advocating for war crimes. And so it's really unfortunate that he would be the front runner in the GOP right now. But I think Rubio can make the case, and I hope that he will hear very soon.
With PSG, what are you guys doing as PSG elections are coming up in April? What, how are you encouraging those students to vote for not only elected office on campus, but also nationwide as well?
Sure. So in PSG, this past November, we had a city council election, and so we really tried to get people to register to vote. We held a few debates. So we're looking to carry on that momentum and keep registering people to vote. And we have an outreach committee, basically, that is charged with going and making sure that people know about the opportunities within PSG, know about the opportunity to vote, and really recognize the importance of choosing a sound, solid student leader who can represent your voice on campus.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Giovanni. We appreciate the interview. We're going to send it over to Professor Josh Scacco back to our panel one last time to wrap up the evening.
And we're back. Thank you so much, Trevor. We're here with our panel, and we're going to wrap things up tonight. Right now, Hillary Clinton is speaking in Miami, Florida, celebrating five big wins tonight across the South: Alabama, Arkansas, Georgia, Tennessee, and Virginia. Donald Trump also has won five states tonight across the South and in Massachusetts. So thinking about messaging, if you're running Hillary Clinton's campaign, what is her strategy from here on out? Jay.
Oh, yeah, of course, I'm in direct touch with Hillary Clinton, so I can tell you all about that. I think early on she's going to have to, or her people, will have to be very aggressive in framing the campaign. I mean, in one sense, the general election starts tonight.
Okay.
And so I suspect things might get negative rather quickly across parties, because you're gonna want to take on Trump.
Okay. And thinking about some of these general election dynamics, if I can actually have put up the results from the state of Virginia, and I know we've been talking a good bit about Virginia, but in many ways, in the past two presidential campaigns, Virginia has been highly competitive in the general election. And what you're seeing on here is Donald Trump has been declared the winner in Virginia, but Marco Rubio's getting 31% of the vote. To what extent could this potentially hurt Donald Trump in a general election in Virginia, a critical state for Republicans if they want to win back the White House? Rosie.
Yeah, I think it's an interesting question. I don't have a good answer. I think Virginia is going to be a tough state. You know, it's going to be close. And Hillary needs to start that messaging right away, as Jay said, and turning it to being about Trump and attacking him. And makes it a little bit more difficult the longer Rubio stays in, or Cruz, or Kasich. But she is going to have to turn it right away and treat it as if it's a general election.
So thinking about some of these messaging dynamics as well, Marco Rubio tonight's doing quite well among suburban moderate Republicans. Robert, do these suburban moderate Republicans, do they end up in the Trump coalition at the end of the day? Or do you think that they potentially bolt the party, they sit it out, they even might vote for Clinton?
Well, this is going to be a long campaign season. I mean, we're just in March, and we're already talking about the general election, because the stakes are so high for both parties in this election, and Trump is such an unknown that many years ago candidates learned the lesson that you just can't sit quietly and let the other candidate define you. So I think people will I can't see Rubio voters necessarily going to Clinton. But there's a lot yet for Trump to define himself a little differently than he's defined himself in the primary, which is what always happens, that the candidates sort of move and become more try to broaden their appeal from the narrow appeal that they do in a primary.
Mm-hmm.
So from that standpoint, I think he will hold on to many of them.
So in many ways, while we have some answers tonight, we also have a lot more unknowns out of these results. And I think in what will make these campaigns uncomfortable going forward is that some things have been rearranged, and that these campaigns will have to fight for some potential voter coalitions that they haven't been able or haven't been, you know, accustomed to doing in the past. So we've reached pretty much the end of our broadcast tonight. At 9 o'clock, there will be a few additional poll closings. Additionally, Democrats in Colorado and I believe in Minnesota are caucusing right now at the moment. It's interesting to think that a month ago in Iowa, we were all paying attention to one caucus, And tonight, Colorado and Minnesota don't even make the radar in terms of the primary process. But there's a lot to play and a lot to unfold in the campaign going forward. We want to thank tonight the Department of Political Science, Pi Sigma Alpha, the Purdue Honors College, as well as the Brian Lamb School of Communication for this particular event. I'm Josh Scacco, Assistant Professor of Political Communication from the Brian Lamb School. Thank you very much, and have a great evening.
Thank you, Josh.